Well, maybe we'll make a start now. Well, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Hamad Nasser, and I'm a curator, strategic advisor, and senior research fellow here at the Paul Mellon Center. Let me extend all of you a very warm welcome. Today, I'm pleased to welcome you to Aesthetics and Ways of Knowing. This is the fourth week of our London Asia Art Worlds program. And I want to start by a big thank you to our panel and to all of you for joining us today. Now, the London Asia Art Worlds program has been co-organized as a collaboration between myself, Sarah Victoria Turner, who's the Deputy Director for Research here at the Paul Mellon Center, and Professor Ming Tiampo, who is Professor in the Department of Art History and Institute for Comparative Studies in Literature, Art, and Culture at Carleton University in Ottawa, Canada. Ming is also the second holder of the London Asia Research Award. Now, some of you may be regular attendees at the PMC events, and for some, this event might be your first interaction with the center. The PMC is a research institute and an educational charity, and is part of Yale University. Physically, we are based in Bedford Square here in central London, where you can visit our library and archive. But we have an ever-growing digital presence, and you can find out more about our program on our website, along with details about our research collections, publications, both print and digital, our grants and fellowship schemes, learning activities, and our future events. London Asia Art Worlds is a five-week multi-part program that's been taking place over May and June 2021 and reflects on ways in which the growing field of modern and contemporary art history in Asia intersects with and challenges the established histories of British art. This event marks 5 years of the Paul Mellon Center's London Asia project, established in collaboration with Hong Kong's Asia Art Archive, and which is co-led by Sarah and myself. The wider project is concerned with excavating the historical, as well as reflecting on the contemporary entanglements that link London, and more widely Britain, and Asia. Now, it does this by focusing on three research strands: exhibitions, institutions, and art schools. The London Asia Project questions the boundaries of national and regional histories and explores new models of researching and writing about the transnational infrastructures and networks that have shaped the histories of art. Now, before I pass over the baton to Ming, let me walk you through the PMC's online housekeeping guidelines and tell you more about how this Zoom webinar will run. Now, I know most of us have probably had more housekeeping guidelines over Zoom than we can stomach, but bear with us. So firstly, just the structure. There will be a keynote paper for about 45 minutes, followed by a Q&A. There'll be a short break, and then three further 15-minute papers with a larger sort of plenary Q&A session. But you do not have to wait until the sort of formal Q&A sessions. Please, as we go along, do add any questions into the Q&A function in Zoom. It'll be great if we have these questions available to the chair and the panel as we are progressing. The online event is being run by the PMC's event manager, Shauna Blanchfield, and events assistant, Danny Conway, and they will be on hand to answer any questions you have throughout this afternoon. And I want to sort of start with just thanking them for the brilliant job they've been doing so far. And long may that continue. With that, I'm going to pass over to Ming.
Thank you very much, Hamad, and welcome to all of you. I'm just going to share my screen. Excuse me for a second, it's not working. Okay. I'm very sorry. Here it is. Of course, it worked 5 minutes ago, so apologies. One of the challenges of a project such as London Asia Art Worlds, which seeks to write forgotten histories, seek new research, and make methodological interventions, is that the sands of colonial indifference and racialized neglect have obliterated even the most basic information about many artists, their exhibitions, and their histories. The surfacing and reconnecting of these traces is of the utmost importance and is a first step towards constituting this transnational space as a field of inquiry. As this project moves forward past the conference, we are hoping to keep you all involved and to ask for your collaboration in nurturing these ongoing research directions as a collective enterprise. To begin with, we are asking for your contributions in identifying artists from Asia who spent time in the UK and artists of the Asian diaspora born in the UK, the art schools that they went to and the exhibitions in which they showed. The intention is twofold. Firstly, to crowdsource and create a database of artists that can serve our community of researchers, you, as starting points for further research. Secondly, to visualize the entangled cartographies of this field emerging between the UK and Asia between 1850 and 2000, between empire and decolonization. So what I'm showing you here is a visualization of some data that I put in with my research on the Slade School of Fine Arts. So you can see that the data is very skewed right now around the Slade School of Fine Art, but this is really to show you what is possible. This next slide shows exhibitions grouped by year, again, using data that I have inputted. So there's an interesting kind of cluster in the 80s and 90s, but I believe that that's probably because of data bias and that we really do need a larger data set. And what I'm showing you here is the series of networks that we can visualize by looking at the exhibitions that artists showed in. What we're hoping is that we can experiment with data visualization techniques that enable us to creatively rethink how art history is written so that we can see new patterns, new geographies, and frameworks. So for example, something that really surprised us was to see here when we looked at the density of UK exhibitions by region, that not all of the exhibitions were in London, something which becomes even more evident when you look at the sites on the map where exhibitions took place. What happens when critical mass data methodologies are used in place of the historical filters that have been shaped by colonial, racist, and sexist attitudes? What happens when we surface the histories of artists who are working together alongside their white male peers, winning awards, exhibiting, getting commissions and building careers, who have now been obscured by the structural biases of art history? This is now a call to action, an invitation for you, your networks, and your students to join us in creating a data set that will help us to visualize these new cartographies. We plan to follow this call up with workshops and edit-a-thons with those of you who take us up on our invitation. And of course, you will be credited on the project when it goes live. We are asking that you go onto the London Asia Art World website's page for the data project, and the link will be in the chat momentarily. There, you will find two links, you can see at the bottom here, one for entering in data about exhibitions, and the other for entering in information about artists. So those links link to these Google forms, which you can then fill out. It should be fairly straightforward. And of course, if your information is partial, please don't worry about that, as all contributions are appreciated and welcome. And here's the the Google form for artist data. So we look forward to continuing this conversation with you and to working together. And now back to Sarah.
Thanks so much, Ming. It's a real pleasure to be part of this conversation with my co-conveners, the panelists, and with you all out there in the audience. And we really have enjoyed in the previous panels all the information, all the ideas that have come through the chat and the Q&A to really feel that these sessions are a way of connecting with a community of researchers, artists, curators, and just interested members of the public. So again, thanks so much for joining you. As Ming has outlined, our hope is that the London Asia Art Worlds project will offer relational stories that negotiate difficult colonial and entangled pasts, shared presence, and also possible collaborative futures. And the papers, provocations, and discussions that are part of this programme are an urgent reminder that the contours of nationhood are complex and of the importance of making worlds rather than of closing them. And of course, it's not lost on us that this series is organised and hosted and funded by the place which I work, the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art. And the pressures, the challenges and the questions that such research as done by the members and the communities that are part of London Asia puts on the framing of art practice and history through nation. And this session on aesthetics and ways of knowing acknowledges the multiple frameworks of seeing, making, knowing, and telling that's fostered in different global sites, and the ways in which the possibilities and problems that arise when these art practices are viewed and interpreted as intertwined. Our chair for this session, Dorothy Price, is someone whose work exemplifies how we can productively complicate the standard narratives of art history by thinking across different spaces, sites, practices, and time periods in order not to just trouble the past, but so that we might plot pathways that move us onwards. As she recently wrote in an editorial of the journal Art History, of which she is the editor, art history today has an urgent need to seek strategies for sustainable, embedded, inclusive, decolonial, and anti-racist futures if it is to continue to thrive. Dorothy Price is Professor of Art History at the University of Bristol, and she was a founding member and inaugural director of the Centre for Black Humanities at the University of Bristol. And she has widely published in the fields of Black British art history and German modernism. She's currently working with the artist Sonia Boyce, R-A-O-B-E, on a special issue of Art History devoted to Black artists and modernism with Imogen Hart, who's at Berkeley, and on a special issue entitled British Art and the Global. Together with the British painter Chantal Joff, she's recently co-produced Personal Feeling is the Main Thing, an exhibition and book about Joff's work in dialogue with the German artist Paula Modison Becker. And she's also recently written about the work of the sculptor Veronica Ryan for her exhibition at Spike Island, which I really encourage everyone to go and see if they can get to Bristol. And Dorothy is also working with the Royal Academy and the Kunstmuseum Den Haag for a fourth exhibition of Expressionist Women. So it's my great pleasure to hand over to Professor Dorothy Price as our chair for the Aesthetics and Ways of Knowing session. Dot, over to you.
Thank you, Sarah. Your introduction reminds me that I need to update my profile. but yes, I'm really delighted to be here. I have followed whenever I can the sessions for this really fantastic set of thinking around the entanglements between London Asia art worlds, and it's really kind of heartening to kind of hear the research that everyone has been undertaking with these kind of transnational purviews in mind as a way of sort of exploding the sort of dominance of Western modernist nationalist traditions of thinking about art and history. So I'm really pleased to be here. This particular session, the Aesthetics and Ways of Knowing panel, acknowledges that the multiple frameworks of seeing, making, knowing, and telling fostered in different global sites pose particular problems of interpretation when viewed as intertwined. And so this section in particular examines strategies of translation and also incommensurability as well. You know, there's not always a sort of neat solution to these entanglements and entwinings. And I think we're going to hear about some of that this afternoon. Our first paper is a recorded presentation from Professor Shigemi Inaga. He has to unfortunately present a recorded version of his paper because there are various university emergencies he has to contend with as a result of the coronavirus in his home institution. But he will be joining us, I hope, for the discussion of his paper afterwards. So Shigemi Inaga is Dean in the Department of Global Studies at the Faculty of Global Culture in Kyoto Saika University. And he's former professor at the International Research Center for Japanese Studies in Kyoto and former dean, Graduate University of Advanced Studies in Hayama, Sokandai. He majored in French 19th century art history, as well as comparative literature and culture. And since his PhD in Paris in 1988, he's developed his field of research into cultural anthropology and intercultural ethics. His books include In Search of Haptic Plastics, published in 2016, Images on the Edge in 2014, The Orient of the Painting in 1999, Le Crépuscule de la Peinture in 1997. And I imagine lots of other papers as well. He's also edited in English, Crossing Cultural Borders, Beyond Reciprocal Anthropology in 1999, and a book called Traditional Japanese Arts and Crafts in the 21st Century, as well as Questioning Oriental Aesthetics and Thinking, 2010. So I can't imagine a better placed keynote speaker for this session today. And he's also curated exhibitions, produced co-edited volumes, and organized international symposiums, including Cradle of Time, Passage of Souls at the Maison de la Culture in Japan. And the title of his paper today is If You're Fluent in English, Put on a Japanese Kimono Abroad, But If Your English is Awful, Better Be Dressed in Western Attire. And he'll talk more about that in his presentation. And there's a link somewhere, there should be a link in the chat. If you can't, so the screen is about to be shared with the presentation of his talk, the recorded presentation of his talk. But if you can't, for whatever reason, because of your internet connection, follow the sort of live recording, if you like, on here, there is a link that's just been put into the chat, a YouTube link where you can also watch it. And then we'll reconvene here, probably at about sort of 1 o'clock, 1:50, 1 o'clock, I think, for the discussion and questions. Okay, so over to the PMC. Well, reconvene at 1:30 if you watch on YouTube. And I think Shauna or Danny are going to, yeah, perfect.
So the title of my talk is If You're Fluent in English, Put on Japanese Kimono Abroad. But if your English is awful, better be dressed in Western attire. And this is a work by Tenshin Okakura Kakuzô at the beginning of the 20th century. So I begin my talk by the quote. So if you're fluent in English, put on Japanese kimono abroad. But if your English is awful, better be dressed in Western attire. Such was the advice Okakura Kakuzô, famous for his the book of tea, gave to his compatriot as an Asian culture choreographer at the beginning of the 20th century. The world was reigned, if not governed, under the British rule. Kimono clothes he is wearing was for ethnic aesthetics, just as English represented the dominant working language, almost synonymous to the universal tool for the appropriate way of knowing. So, ladies and gentlemen, my initial question here to you is to ask whether this statement is still relevant or not in the city of London today, 110 years later. In the case of the city of Kyoto, where I am now, I'd rather say the opposite. If you are not good at Japanese, please do not hesitate to put on kimono dress to exhibit your costume play, exotism. Then you will be respectfully treated by the Kyoto native people as a respectable foreign guest. In fact, the PTO in wearing the kimono costume is quite divergent in Kyoto, and whether you are behaving yourself as a foreign guest or as a native Japanese. For the foreign guest, the Japanese dress code is not strictly applied and you can feel free from any rules. But for the latter case, for the Japanese, if you're a Japanese citizen, a slight violation or ignorance may be indexed as impolite, and you may be shame-free, ostracized from the community of Japanese people. By the way, the president of our university, Kyoto Seika University, he is the unique Black African university president in Japan, is highly respected as his handling of the Kansai local dialect language is perfect. So Black Lives Matter, indeed. And you can also guess why I'm not dressed in a Japanese fashion today in front of you. The second person to be singled out I met a Japanese intellectual traveling to London. Ines is Natsume Soseki, who stayed in London from 900 to 903 for almost 3 years. He is now well known as a Japanese novelist, as a collection of his short stories, The Tower of London, is constantly on sale at a souvenir shop on the spot. And let us examine how Soseki perceived the difference in aesthetic sensibilities between the West and the East. The sixth night episode from his short story, The Night of Dreams, 908, will provide us with a good specimen. The author talks of the 13th century sculptor Unkei. Among his masterpieces, it is a well-known pieces are a pair of huge guardian gods, Nyo, at the entrance gate of the Todai Temple in Nara, which is more than 8 meters high, and which was worth being compared with David by Michelangelo in front of the Palazzo Vecchio in Florence. The story goes as follows. Upon learning that Unkei is carving an image of the two guardians for the main gate of the Gokokuji Temple in Tokyo, the narrator rushed to the place. He finds there a sculptor Unkei at work, utterly indifferent to spectators. I quote, Unkei has just carved out an inch high eyebrow clean across the forehead. Then without the movement hesitation, turning the blade straight down, he stuck it slantwise from above. As he gorged the hard wood off and the thick wood shaving flew away like echoes of the mallet blow, the side of the angry nose with flaring nostrils sprang into view. His style of carving was indeed unceremonious, but showed no least uncertainty. It's amazing how he can at will create eyebrows and a nose when he wears his scissor in such a causal manner, said I, as though to myself, for I was most terribly impressed. The young man aside, and thereupon remarked, oh, you just don't understand. He isn't making eyebrows and noses with his scissors. And what he is really doing is excavating with the help of a mallet and a scissor, those nose and eyebrow shapes and that lie buried in the wood. He cannot go wrong. It's just like digging stones up from the soil. We can easily surmise that the Japanese writer was inspired by the famous story of Michelangelo, water painter, or John Addington are talking about that story. I skipped the quote. Those two books are found also in Soseki's hoarding even nowadays. And we also know that such ideas came from Michelangelo's own pieces of sonnet he dedicated to Vittoria Colonna. And George Vasari also appropriated the anecdote in his La Vita. Yet, there remains a subtle but decisive gap between the Western initial idea and its Japanese interpretation. In the Western view, it is sculptor's mental power of conception that digs an ideal human figure out of the marble. But a Japanese writer denies such an rescued have been already buried in the material from the outset. What is perceived as a metaphor or a fancy by Western art critics does not appear as anything but a sheer material reality for our Oriental interpreter, because stones had been already there in the soil, and the task of the sculptor was no more than removing the layers of sand sedimentations. So the Japanese sculptor in Society Dream doesn't project his mental conception on the wood log to boast his own artistic invention and his talent of creativity. So long as he is obedient to the nature, he cannot go wrong, as is said in the narrating. Yet digging stones up from the soil simply cannot entitle the digger to the grade of full-fledged master artist in Western terminology. So and so that the narrator in Sosek's story, who was a westernized homecomer from London, makes the following confession. I quote once again here. I had never before heard such an analysis of sculptor's art. It made me begin to think that if it were true, then anyone might be a sculptor. And I suddenly felt that I myself would like to carve a guardian god. So I left off watching Unke and hurried at once. And I skip a little bit and to the end of the quotation. So what he did, I dug through every log in the wood pile, one after another, but nay, one contained a guardian god. And finally, it dawned on me that guardian gods were not, after all, buried in trees of this present age. And thus I came to understand why Unke is living to this day. End of the story. The ending of the story looks enigmatic, as is often the case with dreams. And how can we interpret this story and understand Soseki's lesson? Why should the guardian god have disappeared from the modern wood? And I will come back to this question at the end of my lecture today. Now, after this introduction leads us to the first topic. The museum has an exhibition space, but special emphasis on visuality and visual perception. As a result, we are no longer allowed to have a synthetic experience of synesthesia that previous art lovers could enjoy in their private spaces. Especially the gaze is intensified to compensate for the lack of tactile experience. And I, as you can see here in this example, and let me put more emphasis on the invisible side of the culture, which is hidden behind the visual culture today. And just take the case of the ceremony, tea ceremony, as I have already mentioned. Tea bowls should be appreciated. And here is also the case for the Chinese style tea ceremony. And here is also one of the illustrations. Just take the case of tea ceremony. Tea bowls should be appreciated not only by visual observation from a distance. You first have to feel the warmth and liquid within the bowl and smell the tea before and then tasting the bitter grain liquid by touching the fringe of the bowl with your own lips. In the case of tea ceremony, the drinking of the tea is but a small part of the entire process of appreciating art, which invites you into the inner space of tea house, strolling into the garden, admiring the flower arrangement, judging the artwork choices in the alcove, tokonoma for decoration, the sound of boiling water, the smell of the tatami mats, the sound of wind outside the tea room, and even the rhythmical hopping cadence of the bars on the roof, all help the visitors deepen and attune his or her aesthetic sensibility so as to prepare themselves for the approaching ceremony. You may be astonished to notice that in a calm of the tea house, your senses are intensified to such an extraordinary degree of hypersensitivity that even a tiny metal pin dropped in the corridor outside the tea room makes an astoundingly loud sound in your ears. These tea bowls and other similar utensils must feel sorry for themselves once they are put behind a glass of museum display cases. How unhappy they must be, deprived of the chances to be touched and cherished by tea masters. We now understand what kind of cruelty we are committing in museum management. Immanuel Kant was entirely wrong when he declared that the aesthetic value resides in lack of practical use. Contrary to his assumption, disinterestedness, interest lossified here, means the death of aesthetic values. Being deprived of the everyday context of practical use does not necessarily guarantee treasured object a higher status in artistic appreciation. Far from it, conservation in a museum and enshrinement behind a glass showcase may be may well be a death sentence for heretofore cherished object. For the sake of conservation, the objects are taken into custody. Their safety is secured at the price of tactile experience. Losing the chance of direct contact, they are doomed to life, to lie lifelessly in a cemetery, which we arrogantly and proudly call the museums. This is how Okakura Kakuzô, also known as Tenshin, the famous author of the Book of Tea I have already introduced, and the first curator of Asian art at the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, perceived Western modernity. And modernity here means the forced integration of non-Western items into Western museology and the reclassification of non-Western cultures using a template of Western aesthetic categories. In the heyday of imperialism, Okakura uttered a warning against the hasty standardization of artistic values. The current era of globalization may also mean the unification of international measurement and enforcement of a hegemonic global standard. And Okakura cherished in this context a tiny cup of tea and in which he was seeing the hope of a cup of humanity. And how can we treat this cup of humanity properly? And this is the question I wish to share with you today. Now, another merit in the sales ceremony is the practice of touching, the feeling of connectedness in a very wide sense. We can use the bowls and the utensils which our ancestors used even several hundred years ago. And even in modern days, the same behavior is repeated by the current practitioners. We can share the same tactile experience that the tea masters and even the founding fathers of tea rituals would have had several centuries before us. 10 years ago, in 2010, there was a marvelous exhibition at the Kyoto National Museum, which was held, The World of Buddhist Kesaya. Kesaya are garments worn by Buddhist priests. The Japanese subtitle, Koromo Tsutae, Koromo Tsunagu, with a poetic rhythming of ko and tsu, was actually used as a main title in English, transmitting vows, linking minds. Here. However, linking the minds of generations by transmitting robes is not a custom limited only to Buddhist practice. In the West as well, hand-woven bridal lace work, for example, is transmitted from grandmother to mother and from mother to daughter for wedding, generations after generation. Textiles used for the practical and special purpose of hand-woven pieces are painstakingly prepared and manufactured with care. The amount of honest labor as well as the precious time spent on this task are accumulated, concentrated, and literally woven into the textile, making it a privileged product of devotion, one that is worthy of transmission from ancestors to posterity. And to some extent, this veneration of transmitted treasures resembles the treatment of sacred relics in Christianity, especially in the Catholic Church. Yet one basic difference remains. In the case of Christianity, if I'm not seriously mistaken, it is quite rare for believers to directly touch relics. Of course, there are special occasions, but so long as they are enshrined in a glass case for beholding and veneration, it's simply impossible to touch them. In a Buddhist practice of transmitting kesaya garment from master to disciples, touching and wearing historical relics constitute one of the essential factors guaranteeing the link between generations. Some fragments of the ancient garment of priests are known to have been recycled into clothes used to wrap tea caddies or tea bowls, wrapping the precious object by the ancient clothes transmitted from the ancestors also has meaning. The clothes are named shifuku, as you see here, which also coincidentally is a homonymous for beatitude. Dan Fumi, a Japanese actress who played the role of initiator to the tea ceremony, even developed the idea of ai no shifuku, a cross dyed by indigo. Indigo is ai in Japanese, which evokes the beatitude of love. Love is also ai in Japanese language. The careful preparation of the garment for the tea set is no less important than the ceremony itself and much more time consuming. The manual stitching labor is painful at first, but it's very absorbing. To take time in Japanese, tema o kakeru, containing the words for hand, te, and interval, ma, both spatial and temporal, implying the importance of the repetitive manual operation conducted with meticulous attention and care. Wrapped by hand in garment with historical value, the tea bowls surely feel the beatitude of love. The same is true for the wooden box. You can see several of these, you know, dressed up way of the tea bowls. The same is true for the wooden box, which contains a bowl. Being the eyewitness of the destiny of the world it protects, the box accounts for the occupant's historical background, as well as the vicissitude it has experienced during the history. Old half-broken boxes are often as precious as the things they contain. The handwritten inscription on the box is the calligraphic record of the master's hand, and it also serves as a certificate of authenticity. And I'm coming back to this story later. At the Victorian Albert Museum, and forgive me for mentioning it by name, as well as many old Western museums, however, boxes were often thrown away and lost garments were stripped off and from the tea set and classified separately as textiles without specifying their usage. And caddies were put into the lacquer collection together with other lacquers used for different purposes. The tea bowls were forced to undress and reveal their naked skin to the curious observer who peep into the glass showcase without being able to touch them. The original integrity here I'm showing of the object is dismantled and lost once for all, the forced sacrifice for the benefit of rational classification and for the profit of the contextualized visual security. And here is a way how people prepare the wrapping. And here is the contrast of the way how the objects are displayed in a current Victorian British Albert Museum. Though it may sound like a caricature, this is the reality of modernism in museum displays. And it is often said and that wrapping is only done for practical reasons to facilitate the transportation of object. Once transportation is complete, it is enough to remove the wrapping to throw it away and take the object out. The term exhibition in English or Ausstellung in German literally reveals this fact. The wrapping itself cannot constitute in any sense a work of fine art, and it doesn't become the object of art appreciation. Here. It is superfluous and not worthy of preservation, so on and so forth. And yet, here again, I have one intuitive question for this self-evident practice in modernist museology, which I may call the ideology of exhibitionism, to borrow the French connotation of the term. As Jacques Derrida has finally analyzed Ergon, an artwork within is not self-standing without its garment and the support of the parergon, is exhibiting the naked work to the curious gaze the best and the brightest method of exhibiting it in a museum. Is uncensored nudism the best policy? Is the voluntary nudity or the forced nakedness, to reduce Kenneth Clark's famous terminology, of an exhibit the only and the ultimate purpose of display in a museum? Sekine Hideo, here I'm showing his piece. The artist internationally renowned for his topology Earth, and 68 on your left, exhibited several years ago at the Kyoto University Museum a vase-like stone object which with the inscription, which is the translation is almost impossible because of its multiple word braids. Here, and there is the inscription. If you're wondering what this is, you are already trapped in my omotsubo thinking vessel or conniving. Indeed, this vase-like object is not a vase. If you try to see what it contains, you are already duped. The container is made of solid black andesite granite. Its outer appearance makes it seem like a hollow vessel, but in it actually is a solid block. Of a stone. If the viewer mistakenly thinks there is an empty cavity inside, then it is true. It truly is the omotsubo, the trick of the conniving artist. This fake container cannot contain anything except the deception of which the viewers are the predestined victims. This is by itself an ironic message to the exhibition, that is, what on earth can the exhibition contain in the space of an exhibition hall? This outspoken manifest of rejecting the idea of containing was by itself contained in a glass case at the exhibition. And after the show, at a moment of removal, a professional photographer purposelessly put sheets of shadow screens across nonchalantly on this glass case. It so happened that the conniving trick part was half concealed from viewers. I still remember the thrill when I absent-mindedly glanced at this veiled object, half hidden under the shadow of the black seat. That object was really living. It is true that the veiling tends to give an illusion that the hidden object has some secret, mystery, or magical power not to be easily revealed to people without initiation. Yet I wonder if it is really and simply an illusion. One should also admit that a similar, somewhat mystical effect could not be obtained were it not for the removal of textile effects. A solid iron coffin cannot contain any mystery, if not a secret. The location of this exhibition was also not random. Kyoto University Museum, here you have the scenery. Kyoto University Museum is a kind of mausoleum of objects, both natural and human. In the main entrance, we see in the natural history section a fossilized head of an extinct species of elephant and an ancient sarcophagus at the entrance of the human history section. This reminds us of the fact that the museum is a huge tomb, a coffin casket, or rather a morgue. A container where the dead bodies of nature and human history are displayed like cadavers for inspection. It was in this universe of the dead that we decided to organize an exhibition of contemporary art. By law, the jury at the museum should not contain animate object. And yet, the resurrection of the dead was happening around a fake container, the omotsubo I have just shown. And secretly and cachet and without our knowing it, the inanimate turns into the animate in a glass showcase half concealed by the photographer's masking cover sheet. I do not care if the thrill that suddenly gripped me was real or illusory. The fact remains that an exhibition can offer some unexpected effect by not revealing objects under a spotlight. but rather hiding them from the observer's gaze. Many ethnological and art museums are said to be haunted, and stories are frequently told, at least behind the scenes, that ghosts have been seen floating in storage rooms. It is not my intention to deny or clarify such irrational heresy. However, it should not be forgotten that the museum also contains, without our noticing it, the hidden side of invisible mysteries that modernism or naive belief in the process and progress of science and visibility has suppressed under the realm of the dead. The use of lighting for the sake of visual display has also intensified the dark side of the invisible world. What has been oppressed and repressed by the main current of Western modernism is now secretly resurfacing, launching covert redirections in museums without being obviously noticed. Is it a form of revenge? Are the objects imprisoned in the darkness of storage fighting back? Here is the question. Issei Shrine was rebuilt for the 62nd time in the year of 2013. The shrine may be regarded as a reservoir of the imaginary ancestral spirit, a specific museum of the nation dead, be it usually political or whatsoever. As is well known, the wooden container at the shrine building has been demolished and moved back and forth between neighboring sites at intervals of two decades ever since the inauguration of its succession ritual from the year of 690. Any material continuity is rejected by this periodical dismantling of the architecture. Only the spiritual content is supposed to be transmitted from generation to generation through the ritual of succession. It is believed that the sanctuary is haunted by the spirits. The empty vacant site called the Kodenchi on your right, located beside the current used architecture, points to lost origins as well as the coming, not yet realized future. The periodical repetition and reproduction evokes the image of the double spiral of DNA reproducing itself as a token of the succession of life by way of metabolism. Here is also one ultimate strategy of invisibility. The lack of visibility and the rejection of visuality in the spiritual dimension engender a new vision of impenetrable mystery and intimate secrecy within the invisible empty space. According to one English guidebook edited by Basil Hall Chamberlain at the end of the 19th century, a frustrated English tourist is said to have complained that at Issei Shrine, I quote, there is nothing to see and they that is the native Japanese would not let you see it, unquote. It is in this tautological black box of double negation that the mysteries dwell, and they are secretly whispering and watching us without revealing their presence to visibility. If we are interrogating Western modernism on a global scale, why not investigate what is hidden or not exposed? What are the victims of revelation or exhibition as an idea, as a way of knowing? What has Western modernism failed to grasp? What is left behind due to the criteria of Western modernism when it imposes its measurement globally? I remember visiting Marcel Duchamp's posthume work in Philadelphia Museum for the first time in my life in 1939. Many visitors then still did not notice that behind the dirty wooden wall in front of them, there was something hidden. The shabby wall has a peeping hole from which people are invited to have a look at Duchamp's last work, Étant donné. Ryusan's intentional tactic of hiding his secret is highly individual and mischievous. To what extent is Ryusan's fine work comparable to the sanctuary of Ise Shrine? Here is my question. Nestor's question. If the former hides the genitals of a naked adolescent girl and implicitly referring to its sadness in the sense of child abuse, and obviously it's a hidden reference to Gustav Kurz's Origin of the Moon. The latter, the Ise Shrine, is equipped with a no less intentional but fully institutionalized and awfully austere void, the realm of nothingness. Shirakawa Yoshio, a contemporary Japanese artist famous for his documentary book Dada in Japan, once made a tactile exhibition. He pressed Marcel Duchamp's fountain beside the lavatory reserved for the use of the imperial family only during their visit to the Riverside Pavilion in Kokaku in the city of Maegashi on your left. According to Shirakawa, the juxtaposition is justified as both Marcel Duchamp and the pavilion were born in the same year of 1887. This contemporaneity in continuous leads us to a couple of questions in regard to the globalization of modernism. Let us now briefly examine the notion of the artwork as well as that of the copy and the ready-made. So putting the autonomy of art into question and the means of originality versus copy may be demythicized. Apart from being a domestic tool for everyday life, the post-urinal is also a receptacle or container, a functional object to catch liquid excretion. Usually it is not merely because of its indecent role that the urinal cannot claim to be a piece of fine arts. Rather, post-urinal wares are treated in a derogatory fashion as their functionality and utility deprive them of an autonomous status as aesthetic object. The same is true of ceramic wares for domestic use. So long as they serve practical purposes, they are classified as applied art and in an inferior and subordinate category in the social hierarchy. Pitchers, dishes, and vessels do not qualify for the exalted status of sculpture, so long as they are useful and object cannot be regarded as piece of fine art. Once, however, it becomes useless, or suddenly, it can claim the right to be treated as artwork. This aesthetic hierarchy, which again Immanuel Kant justified in critique of Latour's craft in 1790. Has been maintained from the era of high modernism up to until the advent of postmodernism, despite the design age in the mid of 1920s. Mary Anatsue, the contemporary African artist, rescued the used domestic handmill into the piece of work and eluding the human destiny. The juxtaposition of his pieces with Marcel Duchamp. The fountain is merely striking. Western modernity has not questioned the classical hierarchy of fine arts. The supremacy of painting, sculpture, and architecture was maintained even during the height of modernism under the regime of colonial empires. Furthermore, the bifurcation between the fine arts and applied art. Applied art. Were replaced during this period by that between design and decorative arts. And suffice to record the ideology put forward by Le Corbusier or other Rouss, who both manifested vehement hatred toward anything decorative, while tribe art from Africa and Oceania still suffered from hierarchical discrimination in the category of primitive art up until the 1980s. And that's why the comparison is quite striking. However, this scheme is not automatically and unconditionally applicable to non-Western cultural spheres. Let us take up the sphere beside the African case, the case of Yagi Kazuo in Japan. A representative avant-garde ceramist, Yagi could not bring himself to do away with his origin as a master of rice bowl, Chamanya, as he pejoratively identified himself. His generation was strongly inspired by the Japanese-American sculptor Isamu Noguchi in the 1950s, and yet Yagi did not stop asking the question whether or not an empty cavity remains inside the ceramic pieces. Western sculptors do not care about the void within their sculptures. In bronze casting, the empty cavity is devoid of any significance. In marble carving, only the surface of the mass determines the value of a piece. However, for the Japanese ceramic artist of Yagi's generation, the same emancipation from the material was identical with the self-negation of one's previous career as a craftsman, on the left side and the avant-gardist on the right side. Accordingly, his ceramic creations and deeply inspired Juan Miró or Lucio Fontana in the 1950s, and even by Marcel Duchamp, and in an acute concurrence with Jasper Jones, forced Yagi to engage in constant self-mutilation. He confesses that creation meant for him inflicting new wound on himself. His work was covered with cicatrices, one after another. This passivity to inflictions must have been double. So as to emancipate himself, he had to be passively exposed to the influence of Western modernism coming from without. And the very emancipation causes mental as well as physical injuries within. It was in this double mind, that attachment to and detachment from the ceramic ware craftsman that Yagi searched for the ultimate limit of the genre, which has been called sculpture in the West. His historical work, the work of Mr. Samusa, 1954, marks his departure from traditional ceramics. Faced with the convention, Yagi first makes a spherical vessel shaped by the potter's wheel. However, he brutally cuts it to form a circular band without a bottom or top. Simply useless, as it can no longer contain any liquid. Then he stood the band vertically on its side so that it could roll around, and added parasite-like open tubes, which again no longer play any practical role. There are neither vases for flowers nor earthenware drain pipes. They reject any rational explanation of their existence, except for the fact that they eventually serve as leaks to prevent the vertical wheel from falling down sideways. As if to turn this absurd metamorphosis of ceramic ware into a disguised avant-garde sculpture, Yagi borrowed a title from Franz Kafka's famous short story about a man who finds himself transformed into a cockroach, and this, of course, against his will. To become a Western-style sculptor was for Yagi synonymous with becoming a cockroach. Yagi had to destroy the notion of container in ceramics to absorb and contain the modernist notion of artistic autonomy. This receptacle of the Western idea of modernism, named Mr. Samusa, is achieved when the very receptacle, Utsuwa, has broken and lost its practical function as a receptacle. And here is the paradox. And nevertheless, the emptiness within the ceramic piece remained intact, working as a generator at the core of Yagi's creativity. Yagi witnessed this major transubstantiation ceramics were experienced from the 1950s up to the end of the 1970s, when he died. And his career as well, the work was an incarnation of this overwhelming transition. Where the border lines of ergon and paragon were constantly in mutual erosion. How to evaluate his work? here lies one of the tasks that the museum in the era of globalization had to carry out. And with that, I'm coming to my last point today. And this brings us to the dichotomy between the original and the copy. More often than not, the avant-garde or non-Western nations had been accused of being secondary and inferior copies of Western original. If the West is capable of creating the prototype of an avant-garde, the non-Western West of the world is only allowed to produce second-hand ready-made copies. As in the case of Japanism and primitivism, the Western reappropriation of Western sources has not been criticized, although the non-Western sources, be it Japanese, African, or Oceanian, could not claim to be the original of the, or the originator of the Western avant-garde. The mechanism is quite simple. In the case of the Japanese avant-garde, what can be recognizable or recognized as avant-garde according to the Western criteria is, as a matter of course, automatically classified as its secondary European, as secondary imitation of the European goods. And the product not classified or classifiable in the Western theoretical drawer are lumped together under the label of traditional works. Thus, the non-Western world is logically deprived the right to create an authentic avant-garde work of its own and of its own right. And this is not a caricature sketch of what happened at Le Japon des Avant-Garde show at the Centre Pompidou in 1886. And the frustration at this Western centrism in the second half of the 19th century during the worldwide double economy seemed to have erupted on the occasion of the primitivism in 20th century art exhibition held at the Museum of Modern Art in New York in 1984. Yet, it is not my intention to blame, in the manner of Jim Clifford, the West for the economic usurpation, the symbolic monopolization, and the aesthetic self-appropriation among Western artists onto this unilateral balance sheet. Nor am I eager to disagree with Susan, Susan Fogel's strong distinction between the ethnological museum and the art museum for the sake of promoting African contemporary art. Now, what is at stake, in my opinion, in both is the prevailing cult and the obsession with authenticity. Here, allow me to introduce some basic vocabulary from the Japanese language. In all the Japanese, utsushi or utsushi, utsusu or utsushi meant the rear, but utsushi also referred to a copy. The term utsushi is also close to utsuro, void or vacancy. A receptacle is called utsuwa, suggesting a vacancy of the container, utsuwa. Vacant concavity is a necessary condition for transporting liquid, grain, or any other solid materials. The verb to transmit or remove is utsusu, which would be impossible without the vessel, utsuwa. It must be already evident that those three notions, rear and vacancy, utsushi, vessel, utsuwa, and remover or transport, utsusu, share the same etymological root. The semantic associations are no less unconvincing. It must also be noted that during the medieval era in Japan, the idea of the rear utsushi apparently began to connote the opposite term of absence. Under the influence of Buddhism, utsushimi, or carnal existence in the sense of incarnation, became interchangeable with utsusemi, or the body of void, devoid of soil. Soul. Utsusemi, literally a cicada as empty and semi-transparent shell, happened to have a similar pronunciation, and it strongly evoked the ephemerality and the transience of our existence. The real body utsushimi and the cast of skin or slough utsusemi are nothing but two sides of the same coin. Indeed, the rear and the phantom may be the face and the reverse side of the same substance in the process of the interminable transmigration of the soul. Our body is an empty vessel, like a cicada's empty shell, in which the soul dwells for a short moment of physical existence before departing to the realm of the spirits. This is neither original nor unique to Japan. Similar ideas are known to be developed also among the Pythagorean school in ancient Greek. Soma sema in Greece, of course, means the body in the tomb. The brief etymological and semantic exercise about will allow us to propose a new model. This model would serve, if not entirely invalidate, then at least to eviscerate to a certain degree the Western binary opposition between the original and the copy. In fact, the pair utsuru, intuitive, remove, change, shift, mount, catch, and spread, and utsuru, utsusu, transitive, copy, imitate, reflective, infect, depict, and so on, cover a huge semantic field, embracing such notions as copy, duplicate, replace, exchange, succeed, and even possess and haunt. In traditional Kabuki theater, an actor is part of the family lineage of performers, and it's highly praised when he recreates the art of his predecessor, Geiga Utsuru, or the art of the predecessor is copied or transmitted. Implies an almost magical sense of reincarnation or possession, as if the actor were haunted by the ancestral spirit. We can certainly detect here a possible alternative, among others, to the Western obsession with the original and the originality. Let us return to the vessel of Utsuwa, the container of the spirit. Among ceramic craftsmen, there were conviction for a long period of time that the technique of the Utsushi, or the art of making a perfect copy of ancient masterpieces, were worthy of the highest praise. And many of the technical achievements which has allowed the realization of marvelous pieces of ceramics of porcelain were already lost, and the generations remained incapable of reproducing pieces of the same quality with incomparably distinguished aesthetic value. Transmitting this lost secret to the present time was what Utsushi meant for ceramic craftsmen. This high reputation would just seem to have been destabilized by the drastic paradigm shift during the period of rapid westernization, which took place in the second half of the 19th century Japan. With the creation of new patent regulation in 1885, technical secrets have been progressively registered as legal patent. The patent pieces naturally gained authenticity. This shift in the legal system inevitably induced a deterioration of the status of Utsushi in the market as well as in society at large. The once prestigious Utsushi or copied pieces may now be prosecuted as shameful fakes, and Utsushi may face accusations of forgery or fined as counterfeit. A famous Einin vessel scandal, which happened immediately after the Second World War, may be understood as one of the major after effects of this change in values. The copies of Utsushi that a ceramist produced to show his excellence and skill were circulated in the antiquarian market as genuine historical pieces of the 14th century and 15th century. The question of their authenticity led to a scandal implicating an eminent potter and a high-ranking connoisseur. Looking backward from now, however, it is curious to note that they eventually gained greater world fame and authority thanks to this infamous incident. So this brings me back to the initial question. Here's the conclusion. Why should the guardian god have disappeared from the modern world? And why does their disappearance explain Unke's anachronistic survival to this day? The answer should be clear by now. In my opinion, Soseki is criticizing more than the Western way of understanding artist creation. The modern acclaimed artist is an entitled holder of the idea eidos to be projected on the material. In front of this entitled acting modern agency, ancient guardian gods who had been secretly staying in the material, and hule in ancient Greek originally meant wood, and the material were forced to withdraw and disappear. Demons, goblins, and all kinds of spirits had to disappear in the age of enlightenment for the simple reason that entzauberung, to use Max Weber's term, meant disenchantment, the death of all the enigmas. If Unke were still living to this day, it could not have found other explanation, namely because his presence is indispensable so as to witness and to testify to the loss enormous and irretrievable loss the modern industrial age has entailed. To restore these lost demons and spirits must be one of the tasks to be assigned to the Asian artist active in Western metropoles. And may I dare to declare to finish, let me wear kimono clothes for the next time, even if my English is getting still more awful. And thanks very much for your attention, and I'll stop here.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Has Shigemi joined us? Do we know for the conversation?
Yes. Yeah.
Got. Great. Okay. Well, I'd like to thank him. I'd like to thank you, Shigemi, for such a richly conceived paper. That I think was full of questions and provocations for all of us to consider today, particularly in the context of thinking through the entanglements, the collisions, the violence, the invisibilities, and the resistances inherent in thinking through the conditions of London Asia art worlds. There were many potential avenues of discussion today, I think, and inquiry in your extremely rich and thoughtful paper. And I just wanted to start by picking out a few that resonated with me, and then perhaps to start the conversation also with the audience today as well. But I just wanted to start by saying that, first of all, I thought that I found that the trope of sort of latent content, whether conscious or unconscious, visible and invisible, within the material and the materiality of the selected examples you considered, was an extremely resonant way of thinking and of sort of thinking through the kind of issues and problems of Western modernist paradigms within arts histories. And in particular, I was interested in from your examples and how latent content is or isn't activated by different sensory forms of human contact, and also how the visual matrix of Western museums have such a dominant and, in this context, damaging role in rendering objects of culture that originate from outside the West as mute. And so how, you know, a question really for me, and I think for opening for discussion with you as well, is how do we untangle our reach for an expanded global human condition from the scopic regimes of Western modernity? And it's an open question, really. And I'd be interested to know whether you might be able to say, first of all, a little more on that from your own perspective and thinking. I think you've done a really beautiful job in this paper of talking about the ways in which sort of thinking through the conditions of the void and invisibility enable us to think differently about objects from out of the kind of Western colonial matrix. But I think it's ongoing work, isn't it? But attending to the objects and the aesthetics from the objects enables us to have these other ways of knowing. I wonder if you could say a little bit more about that, Shigemi.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So sorry for my bad throat condition and my bad pronunciation. I was very amazed by myself by the bad pronunciation by recording. Thanks very much for this rich questions. And there are two or three factors that I can mention. The first one is, I wanted to put emphasis on the tactility and instead of visuality.
Yeah.
And from time to time, and I dropped out that part of my paper, but those who are visually disabled people can feel better than the usual people. And not only the temperature, but also the, tactile sensations and so forth and so forth. And in a sense, they see, of course, not visually, that they see things better than the so-called ordinary usual people. And that aspect is very important. And some of the contemporary artists are also making the investigation into that aspect of a hidden side, which is hidden side of other side of the visuality. And that is one of the target that I'm aiming at. And second one, I don't really simplifying, overlapping in a simplified fashion, the dichotomy between visuality and non-visual world, onto the opposition between colonial, colonized, and so on and so forth. But still, the museology, for example, visual is one aspect, but this is constantly at a price of other side. And I'm also interested in the other side, and which may be overlapped in a very simplified way on the dichotomy between the West and the rest. Mm-hmm. And that may be the starting point, I think.
Mm. Yes, I like the way you're sort of, I think, if I'm understanding correctly, you're sort of trying to hold both things in play. You're trying to disavow the kind of binary thinking that has really damaged our kind of reception histories of modernism, really, and sort of holding both things in play. And also, I think what you illustrated really beautifully in your talk, actually, through your examples, is that, you know, through the cicada, or but also through the pots and through the sculpture that you showed us, always that attention that we ought to be paying to the void as well as what we see, and that holding those two things in balance enables us to have a different lens in terms of thinking about meaning, I think, and that the sort of scopic regime of, say, Easy Target, but we're going to mention it because you mentioned it in your paper, the V&A, the scopic regime of the sort of museum has sort of really cut us off from a more expanded way of thinking about objects from non-Western cultures, and objects that are, you know, not traditionally sort of fine art, and also how sort of histories of Western art have kind of sort of, in a sense, committed sort of epistemic violence to these objects. And I think your project seems to me to be really a sensitive one of recovery, actually. But I don't want to hog the conversation with you. I don't know if you wanted to respond to that, and then we can open it up to other people at all. I don't know if you want to say more about your project more widely.
Yeah, just simply one thing. Yeah, in a museum space, I'm more interested in the storage room than the exhibit, because something is hidden there. Mm-hmm. And it's also the same with the pot. And people tend to pay more attention on the surface, on the exterior, what is painted there in a Greek pot, for example. But I'm rather interested in the hidden interior, what is hidden there. And both sides is, of course, necessary, indispensable to constitute a pot. But curiously enough, in my opinion, the Western gaze are not as seldom penetrating into the inside. And I'm wondering why. This is a mystery for me.
I wonder.
And yes.
No, go on, sorry. Sorry, carry on.
Yeah, you talked about the scopic regime. Mm. And how would be the secret or hidden side of that scopic regime? That is my question.
Very interesting. Yes, I like the way you kind of raise provocations for us, actually. You raise a lot of provocations in your paper. And we can perhaps come back to them. But Sarah, you've just joined us. Do you have
questions? Hello. Yeah, thank you so much for the paper. And yes, that you say so many provocations about how we treat objects, historic objects now, and the narratives and the meaning that those objects accrue over their histories and through different generations as well. I think your paper also highlighted that for me. Naga, you talked about artistic interventions in the museum and putting contemporary art practice into conversation with historic objects and historic museum sites. Do you think that is a particularly successful strategy for bringing some of these perhaps lost narratives or lost meanings, lost interpretations alive by kind of bringing the contemporary and the historic into conversation through contemporary artists intervening in the museum space? And I'd be interested to note if there's any other particularly interesting or successful examples of that that you know of from Japan or elsewhere in the world that you have researched and worked in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks very much for your commentary and the question. Yeah, I try to, bringing both the classical work and the contemporary work is just asking you if that comparison is still relevant, or for the contemporary artist, is the question that I raised is no longer relevant. So I'm asking the question, mm-hmm. and I'm not quite sure if my way of presenting this contrast is effective, but it's up to the reactions from the audience, from the listeners, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's really interesting. I think that came through for me, actually, that, you know, you sort of discussing how it is that the viewer can activate meaning, and that we are, you know, in the West, we're confined to this kind of visual activation. But what I thought you brought in so beautifully from your account of the tea ceremony and the environment in which the tea ceremony is performed is how it's a sort of much more holistic experience that activates the aesthetic in a tea ceremony, that's not just about going to see the teapot or the cup. And I thought that was a very sort of resonant way of kind of a sort of opening up thinking about what is lost in museums and how then what is gained from thinking about objects sort of haptically, if you like. Ming and Hamad, you've both come in. Do you have, or also the audience, I mean, if you have any questions that are coming or occurring to you as we're speaking, please do type them into the chat or raise your hand and we will come to you.
Well, firstly, just thank you, Shigemi, for a really brilliant paper. And I was just actually thinking, and with Sarah's question in mind, sort of in our own experience, Sarah and I are working on an exhibition of around an artist called Li Wanxia, from China and then Taiwan, and who settled in the UK. And one of his sort of most famous bodies of work, which he sort of generically described as toys, were magnetic discs in which there would be magnetic objects that he would arrange and he would invite the audience to rearrange. And of course, this, you know, in his lifetime, this would be arranged, and, you know, he would organize his exhibitions that way. But post his death, and when these objects become museumified, museums, for the best of intentions around conservation, actually, they refute the possibility of those objects being art the way he had conceived it. And I think there is this, and with that juxtaposition of the void and the object that you showed us so beautifully, I think there is that dichotomy of the art and the object, and that idea that sometimes objecthood actually kind of kills the art. I think it's a wider question around almost as to what should the purpose of museums be? No, if they're actually about the preservation and the study and the engagement with art, how can we lift this fetish of the object?
I wonder if I might be able to jump in here just for a second to maybe build on this question. Thank you again for this amazing paper, and especially under the conditions that you are facing right now in Japan with a state of emergency. What I'm wondering about is to to what extent can we also talk about performativity when we're pushing against this idea of the object and the ways in which the museum enshrines the object as a visual site of visuality? Can you maybe address that question as well when thinking about that transformation?
May I make some commentary, not quite in a context? Right?
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, the first thing is whenever I talk about the tea ceremony, and my Japanese colleagues are quite upset, and I'm quite often scolded by them. Partly because I'm not a practitioner of tea ceremony, partly because I'm, you know, enhancing the so-called oriental aesthetics, which is not really authentic. And third, partly because the way I explain in a rational way the tea ceremony is not their custom at all. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering what I'm doing. Is it the act of conservation, or is it a kind of heresy, or I don't know, it's against the rule, against the convention? And to skip to the second part, yeah, I'm wondering if the museum can be a place where the objects are decaying. Instead of conserving, it may be interesting to see how the things decays. And actually, some of the contemporary ceramists, potters in Japan are trying to make that kind of performance where their objects are decaying in the process.
Interesting.
At the beginning, it's all right. But at the end of the show, it's already broken, for example, mm-hmm. showing that kind of, you know, lack of permanence, I know, is the way how they try to make the performance. I wonder why they like it. Anyway.
Can I ask, related to that, can I jump in? So you talked about the boxes in which the pots transported to the museum, and then often Western Museum curators throw the boxes away, but against the sort of traditions of keeping the boxes and sort of reusing them, and that the decay of those boxes is part of that sort of historical lineage, that time of transmitting knowledge and linking minds. So are the boxes, are they left to decay, or are they repaired? Is there a reparative process involved in that transmission of knowledge? And
oh, it's a very interesting question. Yeah, of course, the wooden boxes may be broken quite easily, and people have to try to repair it. The problem is that in the Western tradition, if it's repaired, it's no longer authentic.
Right.
Ne? And so it's the way how the, you know, heritage conservation, it's the policy of heritage conservation. The original material must be there. But in an oriental culture with wooden, you know, materials, the wood blocks would decay and it must be replaced. And somebody talked about the so-called Theseus complex, as you know, the Greek mythology. And the Theseus had a ship, and it returned triumphantly to Athena, but and dedicated to the god. But 10 years ago, later, 20 years ago, it began to decay, so they had to replace one part, the other, and so on and so forth, in such a way, within 100 years, no original material kept, it's completely replaced. And there is a controversy about that. But Japanese practice of, you know, replacing, either for the, you know, wood timbers for the Buddhist temple, or also the case for the Ise Shrine, and that replacement is part of the practice. Yeah? And that loss of materiality gives a guarantee of the immaterial continuity. And so on and so forth. I don't know if I answered to your question, but anyway,
it's a hint. Yes, very much so. Yeah, I think that's very, you know, another kind of very resonant way of thinking and sort of enabling us to rethink, you know, our practices if we were able to sort of to kind of go that far. But I think, you know, your paper on in general points to so many ways in which there are other modes of attending to aesthetics that, you know, really demand that we kind of dismantle some of our precepts within Western modernisms, not just through colonialism, but just through aesthetic practices as well that offer other forms of knowing. I realise that, you know, we've all kind of spent a lot of time talking with each other. Are there any questions from the audience at all, or points of conversation or comments that anyone wants to contribute to the conversation at all?
We haven't got any on the Q&A box or the chat that I can see, but we can pick up threads in the next Q&A session. So perhaps if people have got ideas that are just sort of percolating, we can follow those up. I know that Inaga Shigemi cannot stay with us for the rest of the session, but we can always pass on questions as well via email and through other social media or other forms of communication, but we can more generally pick up on the chat in the next discussion.
Okay. I don't know about time, whether we should wrap it up or whether...
Perfect, yes. And if people could join us, if we have a 10-minute break, maybe for clarity's sake, actually, we say we join at 45 minutes past the hour. I know people are on lots of different time zones. So that's, yeah, 1:45 in the UK, but yeah, 45 minutes past the hour, wherever you're joining us from in the world, that would be great.
Perfect. And so can I just reiterate my thanks again to Shigemi for making the time, especially under the current circumstances, to be with us here today, and also to prepare your talk for us and to really provide a really rich set of things to think about and provocations for us all as well. So thank you very much. And see everybody after the break.
Thanks, Doc.
Thank you. Hi, shall I start again? Is it time?
Perfect, dots. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, okay. Welcome back, everyone. I hope you've all managed to take a quick break and back again for this afternoon's session. It's my great pleasure to now introduce, all of the speakers, shall I, for this afternoon, Sarah, do you think? And then we can go straight into the each paper, or?
Yeah, that sounds good. That's perfect.
Perfect. Okay, so we have three shorter papers this afternoon, so from three brilliant speakers. Our first speaker is Sadia Shirazi, who is a writer, art historian, curator, and architect based in New York. She's instructor for the curatorial studies program at the Whitney Museum of Art in the independent study program. She's also part-time faculty at Cooper Union and the New School, and is completing her PhD in the Department of History of Art and Visual Studies at Cornell University. Her research focuses on trans-regional histories of modernism and contemporary art across the United States, Europe, South Asia, and the Middle East, with a particular interest in race, gender, post-coloniality, and decolonization. And she's published extremely widely, including in Art Forum, Bidwan, Movement Project Research Journal, MoMA Post, C Magazine, The Funambulist, and also in exhibition catalogues and edited volumes. And her work has also been shown at the 16th Venice Architecture Biennale and in Performance Space New York and the Devi Art Foundation in New Delhi. And Shirazi was a Helena Rubinstein Curatorial Fellow at the Whitney Museum of American Arts Independent Study Program, and also artist in residence at Clark House Initiative in Bombay and Yaddo, New York. So she's extremely busy. So I'm really pleased she was able to join us today. And the speaker after Sadia is Elena Kripa, who is a curator of modern and contemporary art, British art at Tate, where she contributes to the research, display, exhibition, and acquisition of artworks from 20th and 21st century, with a focus on 1940 to 1980 in particular. And at Tate Britain, she has curated large-scale exhibitions, including All Too Human of 2018 and Frank Bowling of 2019, and spotlight exhibitions and displays, including on Joe Spence in 2015, Stan Firmer Inner England, in England, Black Diaspora in London in 1960 to 70s in 2016, Artists Lives, speaking of the Kasmin Gallery, and Kim Lin, Carving and Printing in 2020 to 21. And she's going to talk a little bit more about Kim Lin this afternoon. And she's currently, excitingly, working on Paul Arago's retrospective exhibition opening at Tate Britain in July 2021. And she's also very widely published. And there's a full sort of list of publications on the Paul Mellon Centre biographies of each speaker this afternoon, so I won't go into everything, but I will draw your attention. She's currently, I think, putting to bed the Paul Arago show, so I'm glad she's also made the time to be able to be with us today. And it's also my great pleasure to welcome and introduce this afternoon Eva Bencheva, who is an art historian and curator. Eva is currently an associate lecturer in art history at the Center for Transcultural Studies at Heidelberg University and a postdoctoral researcher and publications coordinator for the international project Worldling Public Cultures, the Arts and Social Innovation. She completed her PhD in art history at SOAS, University of London, and her research and curatorial work focuses on histories of conceptualism, performance, art, and archives in South and Southeast Asia and their diasporas. And her previous positions have included postdoctoral fellow at the Paul Mellon Centre, adjunct researcher at Tate Research Centre, Asia in London, and Goethe Institute Fellow at the Haus der Kunst in Munich, where she co-curated the exhibition Archives in Residence, Southeast Asia Performance Collection with Annie Jael Kwan and Damien Lentini in 2019. And it's my great pleasure to welcome Eva as well, and in fact to welcome all of our speakers. But we're going to start with Sadia's talk for this afternoon, which is titled Zarina, A Post-Colonial Grid. Welcome, Sadia. Hi.
Thank you. Hi, Dorothy. Thank you so much. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, fine.
I'm just going to share my desktop screen. Can everyone see the screen? Okay, great. Okay. In Home is a Foreign Place, 36 black woodblock prints in black ink are arranged in reconfigurable grids that the artist varies depending upon their installation. Instead of exhibiting the works in one row, like smaller portfolios such as Santa Cruz, or the disturbed grid formation of Homes I Made, A Life in Nine Lines, in this work, the artist uses variable grid formats that include 2 6x3 arrangements in which the prints contract into tight horizontal courses and one larger grid of 6x6 in which they expand to the scale of a wall. If Zarina's iconic work, Dividing Line, condenses the history of partition into one thickly rendered frame, Home is a Foreign Place explodes across multiple spacetimes. The prints are held together by a poetic title that can be interpreted as an allusion to a cycle of dispossession and migration and having found a home in a foreign place. Yet it also evokes a different condition and meaning in which home is a place in which one is othered, made to feel as an outsider. This work by Zarina is both epic and episodic. It condenses the artist's peripatetic and exilic life as well as its entanglements with the afterlife of partition into discrete yet simultaneous movements. Zarina's mnemonic aesthetics, her technique for remembering, relies on architecture to recall and then preserve memory. The artist imbues the usually anodyne language of the architectural floor plan with affective and memorial registers. Home is a Foreign Place painstakingly recalls the spatial practices of everyday life in Aligarh, in which habitation is the performance of dwelling, to which architecture is secondary, particularly in conditions of insecure or inadequate housing. In an interesting inversion of post-colonial feminist renunciations of the enclosures of the feminine space of the zenana, or the women's space of the home, Zarina privileges it as a space of sociality, preservation, and care over the nation state as a political space of identification. This portfolio begins with the print Ghar, home. In it, we see a simplified floor plan of the artist's family house in Aligarh, India, which was faculty housing provided by Aligarh Muslim University, where her father was a professor. The plan shows two entrances with corresponding courtyards that reflect a mode of homosocial spatial organization that was common in both Hindu and Muslim households at the time, in which households were segregated by gender, although staff and children queerly passed through both spaces. The top area of the plan depicts the more publicly accessible and visually penetrable men's space called the Mardana, which Zarina's father and his guests primarily occupied, while the entrance to the lower courtyard of the zenana, or women's space, is circuitous. It blocks visual access and affords a higher degree of privacy. A black circle in the image locates us next to the lower entrance of the zenana, or the women's space of the home. In these domestic spaces of feminized labor, where the rest of the work is in fact located, in spaces of rest, care, habitation, and reproduction, that are burnt into the artist's memory and ours after encountering the work. This floor plan is the final iteration of a form that has evolved out of the artist's previous excavations of her childhood home through standalone works such as Father's House, 1898 to 1994, Abba Ka Ghar, and My House, 1937 to 1958. Father's House is an etching that consists of a line drawing of the plan of the house. Every portion of the plan is fastidiously annotated in Urdu to describe the function of each room, a careful self-ethnography and recording of the fusion of space and language. Zarina labels her mother's and father's rooms, the kitchen, food storage areas, courtyards, and the garden's flora and fauna. In the next version of the same floor plan, My House, 1937 to 1958, the walls begin to take on a thickness through the artist's use of poche. As a result, open spaces and courtyards bound by exterior walls are clearly differentiated from the enclosed room of the zenana or women's quarters, which are rendered black. There is no Urdu inserted into this image, and the dimensions of the home are different than in the previous version. Placing the two prints side by side reveals that this is because Zarina has removed the top portion of the house, which contained the men's quarters. This is to say that Zarina's rendering of her house in this work, with these dates of her birth in 1937 and her departure from India in 1958, is solely sited within the women's spaces of the home and through what Gayatri Chakravorty Spivak calls the lens of gender, calls gender as a lens of analysis. It is this space of the zenana that contains the events and experiences of Zarina's birth, her experiences of partition as a 10-year-old child, her adolescence, and the artist's matriculation and graduation from Aligarh Muslim University, after which she was married and then left her home and country. I will follow this move of Zarina's that locates us within the zenana as a gendered space or feminism in translation throughout this paper, and argue that Zarina represents home through the zenana, not as an architectural relic or a marginal space, but as an alternate site of habitation and belonging to the nation state. Moving from home as a foreign place to cities blotted into the wilderness, Adrian Rich after Ghalib, I will trace the artist's use of haptic abstraction, in which floor plans and maps, modes of spatial and cartographic representation, both counter the distanced ocular-centric gaze of the aerial view and avoid the failures of figurative representation that invariably index an ethno-racialized body, offering us instead a minoritarian feminist critique of and counter-narrative to not just colonial cartography and technologies of vision, but also the patriarchal gendered politics of Indian nationalism and of post-colonial modernity and its gendered representations more broadly. The black poche that represents exterior walls in ghar, home, the first print, is now compressed into a single line in the following print, chokat, threshold, the next print in this portfolio. This thick beveled line tightly constricts the narrow space below it, while the space above feels expansive. Zarina relays the feeling of its threshold condition of entry that exceeds its tectonics and is entangled with gender, space, and sociality. The word chokat has a resonance in Urdu that is not fully conveyed by its translation in English as threshold. It evokes a spatial, temporal, and social condition of entry, as well as beginnings and access. The word can also refer to the literal material threshold, the wood that lies under a door. This thick black line expands in divar, wall, a loose perspectival elevation of three walls enclosing a courtyard that moves us out of the omniscient gaze of the plan view. Black is also the color of the earth in zameen, ground, as well as the night sky in sitare, stars. It registers scratches in terror, dasht, while in Zaban, language, empty musical staffs are visible against a black page, conveying a musical notation that is as of yet unwritten, or perhaps has simply been erased. The last print, Hudud, boundary, returns us to a black square, bisected from corner to corner into four equilateral triangles, an ominous image that's akin to a flag of exclusion, that has taken us very far from the interiority of ghar, home, the first print. While the order of the images remains the same in each installation of home is a foreign place, beginning with ghar, home, and ending with hudud, boundary, read from left to right, the Urdu Nasali calligraphy in each print is read from right to left. The work's fragmentary structure and its reconfigurable format encourages multiple readings, directionalities, and modes of display. Although I've taken us quickly through one possible itinerary through the 36 prints, I'd like to note that the artist is not just moving us into and through her recollections of the passage of light and shadow in the day and night, North Indian seasons, or the sight of the blades of a fan upon waking up from slumber in the summer heat, but that Zarina breaks with the stable representation of home in which she begins the work, through cuts throughout the work that function as portals of time and space and interrupt any linear movement through the work, as well as the order of the grid itself, which she breaks apart and re-aggregates depending upon its installation, but also depending upon our own itinerary through the images. Contrary to Rosalind Krauss's claim that the grid functions to declare the modernity of modern art, Zarina's work subverts the seeming teleology of the grid, not to declare or announce as much as inhabit colonial modernity, with its ruptures and breaks that coincide with experiences of violence and the afterlife of colonialism that are not experienced solely as events, but as structures that saturate the very material conditions of everyday life for minoritarian subjects. Flatness in this work does not denote anti-mimeticism, nor does it turn its back on nature. The work's feminist formalism, as I call it, is invested in materialism that does not distinguish between thought and feeling, and betrays an investment in the handmade materiality of the paper itself, which the artist so often likened to skin, saying, "You can scratch it, you can mold it, it even ages." Zarina emphasizes the relationship here between the work and the human body. The artist gathers these moments across time and space together in Home as a Foreign Place, making a whole out of fragments, privileging a multiplicity that is further underscored by the use of multiple languages within the work. Although Zarina's work is often discussed as mourning the loss of an originary home and language, I argue that it is an originary home that the artist centers in her work, a before that disrupts ontological claims to an originary home or language. Her work foregrounds experiences of migration and displacement as foundational to colonial modernity, particularly for what Amir Mufti calls the exemplary crisis of minority. Zarina dislocates belonging as something tethered to the nation state or through affiliation with the Urdu language, through what Naoki Sakai calls heterolingual address. In homolingual address, by contrast, Sakai explains that the addresser adopts the position representative of a putatively homogeneous language society and relates to the general addressees who are also representative of an equally homogeneous language. Heterolingual address, in contrast, does not take a single national, ethnic, or linguistic affiliation for granted. Zarina's work employs Urdu, its translation in English, and its counter-translation as an image that is read visually. Translation and counter-translation are understood to articulate language through certain representations of the labor of translation, prior to which the perceived unity of these languages and communities cannot even exist. I also read Zarina's use of Urdu Nastali calligraphy as both visual and textual, against a reading of calligraphy as solely literary. I argue too that the artist is not preoccupied with loss in relation to the Urdu language, but with language anterior to ethnicity, prior to the ethno-racialization of Muslims, and their conflation with the Urdu language in post-colonial India. Nevertheless, there is an opacity in Zarina's work, an incommensurability, a lack of equivalence that occurs between the Urdu words and the English translations, between the Urdu word and the image, and between the English word and the image that requires viewers to engage with these gaps and slippages at multiple levels of comprehension. Zarina's work evokes both the affective pull of home and its incommensurability as a universal signifier, underscoring the need for multiple iterative translations that we find in her work. The questions of translation, ethno-racialization, dispossession, and violence also arise in These Cities Blotted into Wilderness, Adrian Rich after Ghalib. This work consists of 9 woodcuts of an assemblage of cities: Grozny, written in Urdu as Johar, Sarajevo, Srebrenica, Beirut, Jenin, Baghdad, Kabul, and Ahmedabad. The rough-hewn marks visible in the positive space of Grozny, Johor, Sarajevo, and Baghdad conjure the hand of the artist and the materiality of the wood itself, countering the pure opticality of the aerial view that is deployed in the print. The artist's investment in conveying touch or hapticity through vision, as well as visibilizing temporality in labor, is underscored here by her investment in the degradation that time will wreak on fragile organic materials, such as the handmade paper with which she usually works. Fred Moten and Stefano Harney define hapticality as modernity's insurgent feel, its inherited caress, its skin talk, tongue touch, breath speech, and laugh. This is the feel that no individual can stand and no state abide. Hapticality, the capacity to feel through others, for others to feel through you, for you to feel them feeling you, this feel of the shipped is not regulated, at least not successfully, by a state, a religion, a people, an empire, a piece of land, a totem. Rizvana Bradley extends our understanding of the haptic as an explicitly minoritarian aesthetic and political formulation, a figuration of alterity that simultaneously marks the overlap of and break between thought and feeling. Zarina's work demonstrates this overlap and break between thought and feeling in the way she extends these cartographic representations into this realm of the haptic. Eight cities are represented as eroded city maps in this work. And as in Home is a Foreign Place, the artist also introduces a cut, a shift in modes of representation in her last print of this portfolio, New York. In this final print, New York is not rendered in plan view, but as an abstract elevation, with two vertical lines running through the center of the solid black print, alluding to the twin towers that were targeted during 9/11, near to the artist's home in New York City. And what of the other eight cities? Rather than read the print of Baghdad through the singular event of the invasion of Iraq in 2003, I read it as palimpsestic, evoking the Gulf War of the 90s, the campaigns of aerial bombardment used by the British to control Iraq in the 1920s, and even farther back to the siege of Baghdad in the 13th century. I haven't also forgotten my promise to follow Zarina's move of locating us within the zenana, the women's spaces in her earlier prints. How might our reading of these nine prints alter if we read them also through this lens of gender? The motif of the circle as a location from Home as a Foreign Place returns in this print of Srebrenica. Cited within a mass grave, perhaps it is of one of the many women, sisters, or children who were not killed alongside their fathers, brothers, and sons, but who, as Zarina writes, are the first victims of war and subject to other violences. Zarina's work engages architectural and aerial representations that are the products of the distanced technologies of vision historically associated with colonial modernity that are used as weapons of surveillance, domination, and war, while also thinking beyond them. In both Home is a Foreign Place and These Cities Blotted into the Wilderness, Zarina foregrounds processes of translation, reproductive labor and materiality, and invokes habitation and care as constitutive of home and belonging, particularly for minoritarian subjects within the post-colonial nation state. The artist introduces haptic abstraction to the detached omniscient gaze, thereby returning the view of the figure from above back to the ground, a critique of what Achille Mbembe describes as colonialism's vertical sovereignty with its separation of the airspace from the ground. Zarina employs mnemonic aesthetics in the wake of crisis, displacement, and migration as a form of memorialization of minor figures, a witness who staves off the disappearance of minoritarian life. Thank you.
Oh, hold on. Thank you very much. My video is controlled by, hold on, by the PMC, but here I am. Thank you ever so much for that really enjoyable and rich paper. And I've got a number of questions and I'm sure the audience have too, but we will keep those, if everyone can keep their questions to the discussion session at the end. And we will move on to the next paper now. which is my pleasure to welcome Elena Kripa, curator of modern contemporary British art at the Tate, who is going to talk to us more about Kim Lim's early work, Reconfiguration and Reconciliation. Welcome, Elena.
Thank you, Dars, and thank you also to Ming, Hamad, and Victoria for all the work that has been done for the London Asia and the journey that they've taken us into. I will try to share my screen now. And if you have any problems seeing or hearing me, please let me know. So Kim Lim's early work, Reconfiguration and Reconciliation. So in the past few years, Kim Lim's work has been the object of important research, and of particular note is Joelle Law's essay, Relocating Kim Lim, A Cosmopolitan Perspective, which was published in 2008 in Southeast of Now. The text makes a compelling case for a need to locate Lim's practice as part of the artistic milieu out of which diasporic and immigrant artists in Britain engage with various forms of critical modernisms. This research provides a much needed context for a discussion of Lim's work that transcends the artist's individual experience. Yet, there has been very little, if any, research into Kim Lim's early work. Additionally, and inevitably, looking at Kim Lim's work alongside that of artists as diverse as Rashid Rim or David Madella highlights a common diasporic experience, but equally fails to engage with aspects specific to the context in which Kim Lim grew up and came into maturity. So today I would like to do the following, spend a few minutes telling you a bit more about Kim Lim and her story, and explore how Kim Lim's early work speaks to her personal experience and to the specific geographical and geopolitical context in which it is rooted in a knowing, complex, layered, poetic, and often playful manner. So let's begin with Kim Lim's story, for which I am relying on two primary sources. Cathy Corney's interview for Artists Live at the British Library, which was conducted in 1995 and is available online, and the artist's personal archive, which is with the artist's estate. And what you see in these and in the next slide is sort of a collage images from her photo album, her family photo albums, which belongs, as I said, to the estate, and which I think resonate in a special way with a history inscribed with fragmentation, reconfiguration, and wit. So Kim Lim was born in Singapore in 1936. She was of mixed ethnic and cultural heritage, her father's family having immigrated from China and her mother's family line being from Thailand. Her father studied law in the UK and was a magistrate in Singapore. Lim spent much of her early childhood in Malaysia, then Malaya, living in Penang and Malacca. And this area of Southeast Asia, including Singapore, Penang and Malacca, was part of the Strait Settlements, which had been under direct British colonial control as a crown colony since 1867. In 1941, during World War II, the Japanese army occupied the region and the British left. Lim, who in the early 40s was living in Penang, remembers that the expatriates were taken away very silently at night, while the local population, even though serving in key position for the British rulers, and working as volunteer officers, as in the case of her father, were left behind. This was a devastating betrayal and one that left the family adrift for years. The family lived with little. They had a vegetable garden and Kim Lim's mother resorted to cooking baked goods in the home and sell them. Lim began schooling in a Japanese school, and she found the strict discipline and punishments very upsetting. For years, she developed a high temperature, which enabled her to stay at home and be primarily homeschooled. Her memories of the period are of persistent feelings of threat. And like most people in the region, Lim spoke various languages, Chinese, Malay, English, and learned Japanese. The Japanese rule lasted until the end of the war in 1945, when Singapore was reoccupied by British, Indian, and Australian forces and was made a separate British crown colony. After the end of the war, Lim returned with her family to Singapore, which remained under British control until 1971. In 1954, at the age of 18, Lim traveled to London and enrolled at St. Martin's School of Art, where she concentrated mainly on wood carving. Lim was dissatisfied with the teaching, which focused on the human figure, and 2 years into her studies, following the advice of one of her tutors, the sculptor Elizabeth Fring, she transferred to the Leyde School of Fine Art, where she studied for a further 4 years. She studied sculpture, but also was taught by the etcher Anthony Gross and by the lithographer Stanley Jones, developing a strong commitment for printmaking alongside sculpture. This Leyde was part of University College London, and compared to most art schools in Britain at the time, differed in the emphasis placed on the teaching of art history. Given her life experience, Lim was able to look critically at Eurocentric teaching of the subject, whereby what was then referred to as primitivism was a footnote in the history of the great achievements of European art. Rather than accepting the traditional European canon as mostly taught in our schools and taken as a given by the British art establishment, Lim looked far and wide to find references that resonated with her cultural interests and preoccupations and love of materials and surfaces. She was attracted to sculptures seen at the British Museum, the Cycladic heads she saw in Greece, and which she found to be extremely potent in their simplicity and even having a sort of magical quality. Lim felt that their true art education took place while traveling each summer and stopping to visit museums, religious and secular sites and architecture in different parts of Europe, Southeast Asia, South Asia, North Africa, and Japan, on her way to and back from Singapore. And the images that you see in these slides are a small selection of undated photographs from Lim's personal archive. They just simply give you a sense of the wide remit of the work she saw, studied, and documented over the years. I told you about Kim Lim's early life in reasonable detail to redress accounts to date, which have focused on Kim Lim's experience of journeying and visiting archaeological sites, but have omitted the fact that she lived under Japanese as well as British occupation, experiences which were specific to the Southeast Asian context that she inhabited, and inevitably linked to displacement, trauma, and betrayal. This personal as much as geopolitical history will serve to inform the next part of my paper, which will proceed to discuss how Kim Lim conceived of her own identity and analyze some of her early works. So we might agree that Western modernity's love of raw materials and simplified forms and their making homage and appropriating of the artifacts produced in other localities across the globe, from West Africa to Oceania, is rooted in the assumption that aesthetic qualities can be appreciated in their assumed purity. They can be seen as unrooted, detached from the culture that produced them. And we might also agree that such aesthetic views were linked to Europe's history of moving and appropriating goods, people, and cultures. The geopolitical culture and aesthetic premises underpinning Western modernity is not something a young artist relocating from Singapore to London in 1954 could have aimed to undo. But what she could do, and she did, was to travel to see those artifacts in situ, experiencing them as part of their landscape and the contemporary culture that emanated from their history. Further, Kim Lim took as a given the unrooted quality of modernism love of raw materiality and simplified forms and structures, and made manifest its condition of homelessness and displacement. This was a condition Lim had been made to inhabit, and which directly related to her personally and to the collective experience of migration and displacement of people in her region. Lim discussed her experience of seeing and documenting the artifacts she saw and admired during her travels as follows. I suppose one accumulates on a kind of mental pinboard such experiences, which sometime later act as signposts so that one can find one's bearing, so to speak, in the process of discovering one's identity. I think this statement is key in understanding Kilim's journey is one of taking as a given her unrootedness and the fact that her identity was not given and fixed, but in fact ahead of her in a process of becoming. And I would like to argue that this process of forging her identity as singular and collective is engraved in her work and particularly in her early work. And finally, we are coming to look at some works. And this is one of Kim Lim's earlier wood sculptures from 1959, Sphinx, which is currently on view at Tate Britain as part of an in-focus display on Lim's early carvings and prints. In this work, we can certainly see aspects of Brancusi's work, particularly the wood assemblages from the interwar period. But there is also much more. While still a student, Lim had begun to salvage, carve, and assemble wood offcuts found in woodyards. Their nature of having different prehistories being displaced, cracked by changes of environmental conditions over time, is inscribed in their materiality. Lim added additional layers to it by scorching the surface so that different sections would acquire distinctive textures and reflect the light differently. And I just show you another picture also taken by Kim Lim, which gives you a better sense of the surface treatment. Importantly, Lim did not only highlight materials' quality and their histories, she played with them. She used them as building blocks, which are seemingly precariously balancing atop of each other in a manner that does not follow rules of symmetry or organic or serial development and which create a playful configuration. And I think it's also very interesting that there is so much, such a strong haptic quality to the work. And really when Shigemi and was discussing early in his paper and then Sadia's, I really felt there was a great resonance in terms of the tactile and haptic qualities also of Kim Lim's work. And last but not least, Lim titled the work Sphinx. The title is a hint to the artist's love of ancient artifacts and their eroded surfaces. A nod to the long history of writers and artists referencing the Sphinx as a symbol of hybridity. Hybridity is a condition of empowerment, reflecting and celebrating an enriched and multifaceted existence, rather than one perceived as diluted by lack of homogeneity. Martin Hallman has remarked that Lim's cultural forms imply monumental associations. And yet indeed, there is also something rather witty in seeing in a Sphinx, possibly the immense Sphinx of Gaza, in this contained sculpture constructed from salvaged block of wood. And I will end by discussing two among a group of works made between 1960 and 63, which Lim titled after Japanese figures, including Shogun, Samurai, and Ronin. And here you see two different sculptures titled Samurai from 1960 and 1961. And the one on the right, which is in the collection of the Arts Council, is currently on view as part of the exhibition Breaking the Mold at Yorkshire Sculpture Park. It is important to note that Lim gave the same title to these two works, as this demonstrates that she was not titling sculptures as an afterthought, taking a cue from the resulting formal qualities, but actively exploring particular subjects. This sculpture retained what Kim Lim later described as the raw and arrogant quality of her early works, which indeed are remarkably bold and unapologetic. At the time of their making, Lim was 24 to 25 years old. Much of what we have discussed in relation to Sphinx can also be applied to these works, them being assembled from pre-existing blocks of wood or slabs of stone and being both monumental and playful. Additionally, in the subject of these works, we also have something differently and directly relating to Kim's early life in a more specific way. What did it mean for a child who had experienced a Japanese occupation as inevitably traumatic to go on to make these works after pre-modern Japanese figures of authority? I would argue that in these works, this warrior's history and cultural significance and relevance is equally honored and demystified. These cultures enact a process of healing and reconciliation whereby one can salvage, adapt, mend, and even find irony. We could say that in the process of discovering her identity, Kim Lim turned the passive nature of the condition of unrootedness as experienced personally and as underpinning the aesthetic condition of European modernism into an active stance, furnished with agency, defiance, rapprochement, and a desire to play and tease. And I will just end with an image of Ronin, the Wanderer from 1963. Thank you very much for listening. I will now unshare.
Thank you very much, Elena. Again, really interesting resonances coming through in your paper and across the papers as well. So we're going to move on to Eva Bencheva's paper now, and then we'll come back to questions at the end. And again, just to the audience, if you have questions for any of our speakers so far, please do either type them in the chat and we can collate them or kind of continue to ferment them, and we'll return at the end to all of our speakers for further discussion. Okay, so with no further ado then, it's my pleasure to welcome Eva, who is going to speak to us with a paper title called Incommensurable Abstractions, Rashid Areen and Prafulla Mohanty's Performances Between Britain and South Asia. Welcome, Eva.
Thank you, Dot, and thank you to him, to Ming and Hamad and Sarah and the whole Paul Mellon Center team as well for the invitation to speak today. I'm just going to do a quick screen share. Okay, so if everybody can see that. My paper in a way follows not only from the fantastic papers before me and from Professor Inaga's talk also earlier in the panel, but it also connects to some of the ideas that have been cropping up throughout the conference earlier. And so I'd like to start with this idea, an idea that has been circulating around in the last 20 years in particular, that the once sort of celebrated universal quality of abstract art is now widely contested. In her opening talk for this conference, Leela Gandhi talked about the interplay of visibility and invisibility in abstraction. Abstraction, she noted, was also a way of kind of speaking about hidden systems of knowledge. Now, thinking about art and about painting in particular, I can't help but think back to Covenant Mercer's seminal edited volume titled Discrepant Abstraction, in which he notes that abstraction was mobilized within decolonial and postcolonial thought. Coming at a slightly later time was Okwien Wesor's introduction to the exhibition Frank Bowling, Mappa Mundi, in which he interprets abstraction as a kind of mapping of invisible and unspoken histories, connections, but also differences. And it's through the lens of these unravelings of abstraction that I today would like to present the work of two wonderful artists, Rashid Areen and Prafulla Mohanty, whom you see here on the cover screen. I bring them together not only for their rich work with abstraction, but also for their self-reflexive explorations of the transnational and transcultural resonances and readings also of their works. Through their art, but also through their writing, both artists have voiced a concern with the incommensurability or the different standards, interpretations, and expectations cast upon their works. This varies not only according to geography and time, but also according to language, power relations, and culture. And what I find really fascinating in both of these artists is that they actually channel this unfixed status of their work as a way of critically questioning the relationships of aesthetics and universality. Born in Karachi in 1935, Rashid Areen's early works were marked by a number of figurative portraits and landscapes of Karachi. However, his work also had a strong element of abstraction, in which curved lines and geometric forms, often based on experiments which the artist himself carried out with everyday materials, started to crop up within his artworks. Another important influence for his abstraction were urban forms. In particular, as Iftikhar Dadi also notes, not just urban structures, but also abstract forms arising from Islamic calligraphy, history, and philosophy. With a training in civil engineering, Arain came to the UK in 1964. Throughout the late 1960s, he began to combine his interest in abstraction with a kind of experimentation with three-dimensional installations and sculptures, more commonly known as grids, for which he's fairly well known today. But more importantly, several of his works from this period also took on a markedly relational and playful nature. And here I show you photographs of a series of works called canal events, more broadly, also sometimes termed chakras, which entailed the throwing of rounded abstract discs by groups of friends, colleagues, or simply passers-by into canals and waterways. So the picture on the left is from London, and as noted by art historian Courtney Jane Martin, this kind of collective action was also Arain's way of engaging with London's urban space on the one hand, but also overcoming certain political and personal senses of isolation which he felt at the time. The images that you see on the right.
Art Worlds is a 5-week conference that reflects on the ways in which to grow.
What's that? Have we been Zoom bombed? Are you?
I think it was more of a sound bomb.
Okay.
I'll just continue. So the images that you see on the right were when the work was executed in Paris in 1970. And here it's not so much anymore about the urban structures as it is also an expression of solidarity with the 1968 political protests, the union and student protests that had happened at the end of the decade. For Arain, however, very importantly for both of these iterations, was another element, and that was embracing the forces of nature as a way of symbolically kind of challenging the systems of hierarchy and power and control within the structures of Europe. And I bring this up because this is one interpretation which in a way gets also lost when the work comes to be performed a couple of years later in 1974 in Karachi for the first time. And here you see the discs once again floating on the surface of the water in Jeel Park in Karachi, a work that was executed in a very similar way with acquaintances of Arain gathering together and throwing the discs collectively. However, the making of this work within Pakistan also marked a certain turning point in Arain's thinking. Here, it was no longer about symbolically challenging Western hierarchies by kind of drawing on the random forces of nature, taking the discs away. Rather, it became a symbol of connectivity and interdependence, an idea that Arain would go on to explore in a number of his writings and other works throughout the 1970s, most notably Preliminary Notes for a Black Manifesto and the magazine Black Phoenix, which he would go on to publish. Simultaneously, however, the work was also received in quite a different way within Pakistan. From the very few reviews which are actually available on it, most of them seem to deal with the work in terms of its aesthetics. They speak of a kind of beautiful ripple effect happening when the discs are thrown on the water. And there's a very strong contextualization of the work also within a Euro-American avant-garde practice. This reception for Arain also signaled a certain incommensurability within the art world. On the one hand, his works having been situated quite firmly within minimalist practices in Europe and seen, on the other hand, as foreign and experimental from the side of Pakistan. This is a subject which he would come to explore through a series of writings and idea-based works almost three decades later. These would deal not only with the incommensurability of reception of art, as this review shows, but also they would substantially delve into the different lived experiences which actually underpinned those different receptions. And here I think he's tapping into something that art historian Monica Juneja has recently referred to as a kind of critical globality. So recognizing local differences as a kind of questioning the sort of the universalizing tendency of the word, the global. So the series of works that I'm talking about go by the broader title of Return to Baluchistan. And what you see here on the screen at the moment are photographs taken by Arain himself in the 1970s and 1980s in the region of Baluchistan, which is to the southwest of Pakistan. It's a desert province, which also borders with Iran and is one of Pakistan's most arid and rural areas. So this was also an area where Arain spent a substantial amount of time in his early childhood. In the essay, Return to Baluchistan, Nominalizing the Bourgeois Aesthetic, written in 2001 and delivered between 2001 and 2002, and then subsequently published in Arain's book, Art Beyond Art, the artist offers reflections on this as one of the poorest provinces of Pakistan. However, he also reflects upon rural poverty and third world life, also as a product of global capitalism. These reflections of the third world are also extended to think about the role of intellectuals in the third world, which he notes for him are also complicit with certain international capitalist forces. And he also voices a desire for art that departs from Eurocentric canons of art, which he sees as trapped within a bourgeois premise. So this is a kind of a series of reflections that comes out also of the product of having shown his work across multiple spaces and having also observed different responses to it. But it's also a kind of an exercise in abstraction of its own. Through it, Arain also launches another series of works which are more map-based and also kind of conceptually abstract in their own way, in which he proposes, and I quote, one way to stop thinking about the West as the society or as the center of the world. So on this map in particular here, for example, you see a series of nodes. You see also where Pakistan is, the city of Karachi, also bordering the province of Baluchistan, being as one in a series of nodes connected to other parts of the world, either through a collective consciousness or an individual consciousness. So what these two series combined do is they actually advocate for a more also material and philosophical way of creating art in order to engage with the struggles of deprived peasants and exploited workers of the world. And importantly, Arain actually elaborates this through two notions. The first one is that of nominalism. It's a term that comes from medieval thought and denotes the idea that universals and general theories are mere ideas with no corresponding realities. What Arain does here is he makes a call essentially to account for local epistemologies and ways of living. And he refers to this as the nominal. In other words, making art the subject of things that are within everyday life, that are lived realities within everyday life. So he advocates for a kind of art making that is a collective creative activity that gives creative solutions for rural dwellers. So it's a kind of art that is also not divorced from social processes. And sort of building onto this is his notion of cosmo-ruralism, which follows, in which he actually critiques urban living and suggests that it's one of the main causes also for the destructive forces of anthropocentric living. Through both these terms, he makes a plea, essentially, a plea for creative solutions for sustainable infrastructures in rural underdeveloped areas. So we can also think about this as a kind of act of translation, a certain translation of Arain's own abstract practices away from their bourgeois connotations and into the context of the nominal, the grassroots, and the lived experience. However, what's important to note here is that these ideas, and Arain himself also refers to them as ideas, are propositions that are rooted in design solutions and development solutions. They live on today in the form of writings and sketches and talks. But now what I'd like to do is turn my attention to another artist whose work has also similarly initially stemmed from a place of abstraction, but over the times, over the period of time, also recognizing the limits to its universality, has also shifted towards a more localized, non-metropolitan engagement. And the work that I'd like to present is that of Profula Mohanty. Born in the village of Nanpur in the state of Orissa in India in 1936, Mohanty studied architecture in Bombay before migrating to England in pursuit of further study and professional development. He arrived in Leeds in 1960 and registered to study town planning. And here you see Mohanty on the far left with fellow students from the town planning class. Fueled by feelings of social isolation at the time in Leeds, Mohanty began painting in the 1960s. His initially vibrant watercolor paintings had certain motifs and designs on them, which over time became more and more abstracted into the form of concentric color circles. Simultaneously, to sustain himself financially, Mohanty began teaching evening dance classes to students and businessmen in Leeds. Gradually, by combining the two, he developed a form of abstract dance performance, which was loosely based on Indian Kathak dance, and which the artist also related back to his painting. So he has this beautiful way of describing it, saying, when I'm painting, I'm dancing. In 1964, he staged the first official performance of this at the Leeds City Art Gallery. This was his first painting performance, in which he positioned his own canvases amidst the old masters and proceeded to dance around them. In the late 1960s, Mohanty moved to London to work as a town planner for the Greater London Council and continued to develop these performances, also staging them over the course of the 70s internationally. The emphasis, however, on this point started to be on his hand gestures and the abstract nature of the works, which became increasingly interwoven also with the discourse of modern art. And here I show you a photo of his first solo exhibition at the ICA from 1970. Mohanty used the term pure dance to describe his works. And this is the kind of first incommensurable moment which I'd like to discuss in relation to his work. Through this use of the word purity, Mohanty's work often came to be contextualized by his curators and reviewers as an allusion to the notion of pure, as it was being used by theorists such as Clement Greenberg at the time to represent a kind of pure abstract form and a division between different media. For Mohanty, however, use of the word pure was not about the separation of the media. His painting, his dance, and his writing all formed for him a kind of composite practice which was meant to be seen together. Pure, as he also used it, was a way of distancing himself from fixed categories of identity politics. Initially, this had been to distance himself from notions of traditional Indian art and dance, and later it also became a way of distancing from more fixed and restrictive notions of Black art. While Mohanty never formally partook in the activities of the British Black Arts movement in the 1980s, he very much ascribed to their struggle of overcoming racial discrimination and gaining equality, and he has described many of his experiences, observations, and struggles in detail in his book Through Brown Eyes, which I would all encourage you to read if you haven't until now. So this kind of these sort of distinctions in the use of the word pure is the one level of incommensurability. The second one, which I'd like to explore, though, is maybe traced back to the international showing of Mohanty's works. Starting with an exhibition in Delhi in the 1970s, Mohanty's work first came to be framed under the rubric of neo-tantric art, which was starting to gain a lot of international prominence during the 1970s. In particular, the circle formation of his paintings were seen as representative of the birth, life, and regeneration cycles. Also the bindu dot and the concept of shunya, the void, the nothingness from which all life emanates. Within this kind of neo-tantric framework, his work came to be shown in exhibitions between the 1970s and 1990s in India, but also in Japan and the Philippines and in Germany. This interpretation persisting up to this very day, and here I've included the cover image of the catalog for a recent exhibition at the British Museum on Tantra, in which Mohanty's works were also featured once again. And yet Mohanty's own relationship to tantric expression has not been such a clear-cut one. Arguing for tantric forms as an ingrained part of a wider kind of visual lexicon, Mohanty has actually rooted his biggest influences within the lived realities of his native village of Orissa, of Nampur in the state of Orissa. Here, Tantra is one among a myriad of other influences. And the figure of the village is itself, in a way, a much bigger driving force within his overall practice. It's both prominent in the personal and the formal influences of his abstraction. He's spoken, for instance, about the circular form as having a relationship to Oriya script, which has this kind of rounded, curvy linear form. He's also related it back to childhood memories of drawing concentric circles as an act of meditation and the worship of deities, Brahma, Vishnu, and Maheshwar. He has also connected the act of making circles to shalagrams, small oval stones worshipped by the artist's mother when he was growing up. So here is another one of his publications called My Village, My Life that I've included here to kind of emphasize the prominence and the imagination of Mohanty, of the figure of his village, which quite often gets left out of certain accounts of his work that focus on their abstract nature. Further to that, I'd just like to end with this slide as well, emphasizing an aspect of Mohanty's practice, which is different from Arain's notion of cosmo-ruralism, which is a detached abstract idea in a way. Mohanty also returns annually to Nanpur. At the age of 85, he continues to do that to this day, including, if I may add, throughout the COVID pandemic. So this is a kind of a much more real life commitment to the idea of using the village also as a building block, but also as a source of inspiration and as a material as well for art making. It is a kind of practice rooted in real life exchanges and mutual inspiration, which sometimes becomes difficult to account for within discourses that are strictly rooted on modern and contemporary art. So just to conclude, I would like to think about abstraction in the case of Mohanty, not only as a bridge between the contemporary art and the local world of Nanpur, but also as an embodiment of these differences. Returning back to Leela Gandhi's observation that abstraction plays a role in communicating systems of knowledge that often remain obscured, both Mohanty and Arain have aimed to establish, on the one hand, a kind of cross-cultural dialogue or translation through their work. But on the other hand, their works have also taken on a life of their own. And through that, they have illustrated the incommensurability not only between art centers, but also between the rural and the urban divide. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ava, for that really fascinating paper. And indeed, to all of our speakers this afternoon, can I invite them all to turn on their cameras again? Just give you a moment while Elena and Sadia turn their cameras on. Hello. Hi, welcome back. Thank you all so much. It's been a really rich and fascinating afternoon. So many interesting resonances, I think, across the papers, particularly in terms, I think, of issues to do with obviously abstraction and modernism and other modernisms and other sort of experiences and uses of abstraction not stemming from a kind of Western modernist perspective, but being received as such, and then the tensions and, as you say, the incommensurability in those receptions is really interesting, I think. And a sort of, you know, the interaction between materiality and meaning, and how meaning is embedded in the materiality of choices that the artists make, but also how it's kind of misread as well, I think, quite often, depending on the context. And also, I think the collision of personal and political histories is something that's really strong in all of the papers this afternoon, and sort of geographies and mapping and plotting and plans and kind of geographical location is key, and also the personal and the political. We have a question already in the questions, so I will go straight over to the audience, actually, and hopefully, you know, more questions will come in as we're speaking. There are a couple of questions now. So the first one, a great question from CC Lee, who asks, she says, identities are never singular, but multiply constructed across different, often intersecting and antagonistic discourses, practices and positions. So cultural identity is constantly changing. Under this change, is modern Asian art presenting, quote, what we can become today, more importantly than who we are or where do we come from? A really kind of interesting question. And I'm going to throw it open to any of you to think about or to answer in relation to your topics this afternoon or your thoughts. Ava.
Yeah, I think the question hits the nail on the head in many ways, and it's Stuart Hall's argument as well, that identity is always in a state of flux and always in a state of becoming. So rather than saying it should be written a certain way, we just need to look at, we need to acknowledge that there are different ways of framing and ask ourselves who is doing the framing and with what aim in mind. For those of us who work on diasporic art histories, this notion of becoming is an extremely valuable one and a productive one for thinking about these things. For somebody aiming to write an art history from a more national, perhaps recuperative art history, maybe the positioning there is different, but I don't know how the others see that.
Yeah, do either of you want to come in there? Yeah, Elena.
I might just add, yeah, that I read a quote in my paper precisely, I think, that refers to that, where Kinlin says that, you know, she used a sort of pinboard of what she saw in the world as tools in what she defines as a process of discovering her identity. And I think in all the statements she made and reluctantly answered questions about her identity, there was always a sense that her identity was ahead of her rather than behind her. And I think it was never about denying her history at all, which of course is also in her work, but wanting to propose or focus more on the journey ahead as much as on the past. And I think this is also part and parcel of a refusal to partake in Rashida Rin's The Other Story, because right or wrongly, that's exactly what she feared, was that sort of being fully molded into that past identity rather than in the way her work was developing.
I think that's a really important point, actually. And it's very difficult to untangle, what others, how others perceive you and receive you in relation to how you're trying to create meaning or construct meaning for yourself. It's a constant tension, I think, for a lot of the artists we've been talking about today, and indeed in general, actually, as well. So yeah, thank you for that. Sadia, I don't know if you want to add anything to any of that.
Just to follow with what you were saying, I think that at least with Zarina's work, the question of I think I'm not interested in the question of identity or the way in which the artist identifies or anything like that, but thinking about how there are structural paradigms that name the artist, whether or not that's the way that the artist kind of names himself. So if you think just about, in the context of India with the Babri Masjid, the destruction of the Babri Masjid in the 90s, there's a way that Zarina's generation identified as Indians in the post-independence, post-colonial period, but then became identified by religion, what I call kind of ethno-racialized religion. And so it's almost that Zarina couldn't identify otherwise, and so then that's when she comes to kind of speak about herself as, I think if you're facing conditions of persecution, you begin to take a position in relation to whatever part of your identity. I agree, it's totally intersectional and keeps changing, but it becomes a kind of political question, I guess.
Yeah, I think that's really interesting. I think that came through as well in all of the examples you were all talking about, that intersection between the personal and political, and how they all engage with that or sort of deal with it in their work, and how it can't be untangled, but it's a question of how then one sort of decides to play it, I guess, in terms of the art that is made and how it's received. I think that's a kind of ongoing resonant kind of sort of live set of issues. We have another question in the chat. We have two, in fact. So one from Kylie Gilchrist, who says, thanks very much for the incredibly rich papers. And her question runs across the panel regarding the significance of the haptic. To what extent does the haptic in the work of Zarina, Kim Lim and Rashida Rin compel a rereading of Euro-American traditions alongside and in dialogue with those from Asia? And I'm thinking, for example, of Harold Rosenberg's emphasis on action rather than flatness in modernist painting, and Herbert Reed's emphasis on tactility over opticality. Both thinkers more committed to internationalism than Greenberg, and who are eclipsed by Greenberg's formalism. In response to Shigemi's very rich paper, I wonder if you could expand on your thoughts regarding methodologies that enable the translation of lived, tactile, haptic context, countering the formalist and decontextualized paradigms of the museum. Wow, great question, Kylie. I don't know who feels like they want to take that, or whether Kylie wants to unmute herself and actually talk a little bit more about the question. Are you there? Okay, perhaps not, in which case. The haptic then in the work of your artists that you have selected.
Hi, I think I'm unmuted now.
Okay, great.
Thank you to everyone for your papers. And I think I was quite interested in this pressing upon the dominant paradigm of, let's say, formalist modernism in Greenberg, which of course has been sort of endlessly displaced, but perhaps not enough. And the way that I think all of your work invites a kind of local rereading of these different traditions in dialogue with other traditions in the Euro-American context that have been sort of marginalized themselves. And so I'd be curious to hear kind of more specifically, for example, Sadia, what is Zarina's dialogue in New York with other art critics or art historians? How does she see her work in dialogue similarly with both Elena and Eva? How do you see that operating in both Rashid and Kim's work? So yeah, I'd be curious kind of the granularity there, and maybe that sort of preemptively responds to my other question about translating context. So yes, thank you.
Don't know who wants to take it first.
Yeah, I can just begin just by saying, I mean, of course, it's a very good question, and particularly for an artist who uses sculpture and lithograph, which are, you know, haptic, essentially, activities. I think, you know, we can contrast Greenberg's emphasis on vision against someone like Herbert Read, who very much wrote about the giving prominence to tact and touch over seeing, particularly in sculpture. And yet that belongs to a generation which nonetheless saw these objects, I think, in a more detached way. And going back to the keynote today, and that, you know, the discussions about the tea ceremony, whether that is exotizing the subject. And yet I think what the keynote was very good at, it was telling us about the difference in which, the different way in which we experience objects when we are situated and we are joined up in a circle or in a community, in a context. And I think one of the things that for me is very important about what Kim Lim did is she didn't just sculpt and use lithograph and use this very, her gestural is embedded in the work, but she went to look at the artifacts and artworks and architecture she was interested in situ. And I think this is hugely important and different from the experience of so many other artists who at the time were going into just the British Museum, but at, you know, that much more detached experience from the object. Mm-hmm. I think this is one of the characteristics that distinguishes Kim, and I think this is where her traveling is incredibly important and relevant, not just in terms of the sources, but in terms of this very different, more uptake, more embedded and culturally attuned to the specificity of the place that she applied in her work.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Elena. Do either of you want to talk a little bit more about the haptic? Yes, Adia.
Sure. Thank you for the question, Kylie. So I think, I mean, the question is very interesting, and I think it's very productive, you know, the rereading of Euro-American traditions, right, alongside and in dialogue with those from Asia. I would say that I think what I'm going to offer is kind of polemical, which is that I think I am doing that in the paper, and I would include the Black radical tradition as part of the Euro-American tradition. And so, you know, I'm relying on the theorization of haptic and hapticality that's coming out of Black studies and Black radical aesthetics. And I think that that is drawing alongside an engagement of the question of hapticality in Zarina's work with a Euro-American tradition that actually challenges, I would say, maybe the discipline of art history and its kind of Euro-American epistemologies, who we consider as the texts, theorists, writers, and artists that we're in conversation with. And so I think, you know, Herbert Reed, you know, and Harold Rosenberg, who you mentioned, you know, who are much, you know, you say internationalist in comparison to Greenberg. I think that's very true. I think it's just that, you know, I'm putting the people in Euro-American kind of traditions that I'm in conversation with are bringing Ozzorino's work and like post-colonial studies in conversation with, I would say, is the Euro-American tradition itself.
Yeah, thank you for that. Yeah, I think you referenced Fred Moten, didn't you, in your talk? And you know, that was really interesting. His take on the haptic as a kind of centralizing that is kind of really, I think, productive for thinking through materiality history as well. Thank you, Eva. I don't know if you want to have anything to say about the haptic.
Yeah, I'm slightly struggling to make generalizations about it between Rashid Arain and Profulo Mohanty, because their approaches are slightly different. When I think of haptic in terms of Arain's work, I have to think not only of canal events where people pick up the discs and they throw them, but also works like Zero to Infinity, which are made to be assembled and reassembled by multiple groups. And in both those cases, they were meant to create a kind of, yeah, in a way, a more universalizing feeling of this is a common activity that we can all relate to in a similar way. It's not laden with certain cultural understandings. Whereas for Profulo, when he talks about the haptic as painting as a physical process for him, and something that should not just be seen as visual, but also as performative and as bodily, for him, that has a much more tangible connection to the physical embodied process of being in the village. And that's what makes his paintings in a way harder to understand in terms of the haptic, if we're looking from a, perhaps from a European point of view, but it's the crux of his work at the same time. So the visual is not enough there. Following on from Professor Inaga's talk this morning, we do need a more phenomenological approach almost to even rethink something that is just a flat canvas. Yeah, so that's what comes to mind for me.
Yeah, that's really interesting, isn't it? Because it's, you know, it's all a kind of, oh, just happened.
All personnel, please exit immediately.
Order, order.
Well, that was dramatic. I don't know if we've lost some people en route, but anyway, apologies for that. Hope we have still, we do still have 43 people in the room, so that's great. I've never been Zoom bombed before, so that was a new experience in a whole kind of over a year's worth of Zooming. So yeah, thanks for bearing with us. Well, had we come to the end of our discussion of the haptic, potentially? Okay, let's move on to the next question. I presume we still have time. I hope we have time. I'll wait till anyone interrupts me and we'll just carry on until someone does. So we have another question from Aparna Kumar, who says, thank you for your wonderful papers, extremely rich panel. And she has a specific question for Sadia. And she says she's really taken by your beautiful reading of Zarina's two series, specifically how you see them disrupting the linearity of time, history, and lived experience. of both the artist and the viewer, a linearity often privileged or imposed by histories of Western modernism. She wondered whether you can expand on how the display of these series plays into your arguments. And she was struck by how you located Gar as the beginning of Zarina's Home is a Foreign Place series and New York as the end of it, of these cities blotted into wilderness. She wondered why you located them as such and if it's a factor of the display or making of the work or of Zarina's preference. And does her work interrupt your understanding of beginning and end? Good question. And so often anchor or understanding the narrative. And I wonder if Aparna is still there, whether you wanted to unmute yourself and show yourself and have a discussion, perhaps. Give you a minute to do that if you want to or not. Well, Sadia thinks about the answer. Okay. Oh, hi. We see you. We don't yet hear you. Hey.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. Okay. I was really taken by your reading of both of the works, Sadia, and I really wanted to kind of just hear you expand a little bit about the display of these works, because one of the things that I've always encountered with Zarina is that there is no stable display of the works. Like, I've seen them displayed in so many different ways, which I've also found to be such a, you know, a function of the kind of disruptive potential of her series. And I was just really curious to, and I know that you also kind of in the course of your PowerPoint also showed different ways in which the series were displayed and how it kind of interrupts our kind of understanding of the grid. And so I was just curious to know if that was also a factor in how you're thinking about and engaging with Zarina's work. But thank you.
Thank you so much for that question, Aparna. So, it's helpful to hear that the way in which the presentation is heard by the audience as well, because things might come through that we don't, that we need to clarify. So I would say it's very helpful to hear that that's how it's reading. And I will definitely change a little bit in the paper to adjust that. Because so in the Home is a Foreign Place, the reason that I kind of began with Ghar is because, I can't speak to Zarina's preference herself, but when I talk about the work, I talk about how, you know, her work has relationships to books and to the kind of printed page. And the prints are arranged in a, are changing in the way that they're arranged. But if you look at it as kind of, like in Santa Cruz, have three images, and then you have, you know, a phrase from Fez's poem in Urdu. In Homes I Made in Nine Lives, you have this kind of compass that's located at the bottom. So there are sometimes, what I'm calling these cuts, where Zarina moves us from one stable mode of representation to other modes. So when I talk about Ghar in Home is a Foreign Place, Home as the first print, it's because it kind of is an index that locates us. In a print like, in a work like Santa Cruz, where there are these three kind of, this is the first that I showed, where it ends with a kind of, with the Urdu poem, I would say that's a cut. And so I'm trying to, when I talk about the works, I intend to kind of disrupt that linearity very much. And so I think I can think of it and present it more as these cuts. But in Home as a Foreign Place, I'm quite interested in that plan also because of the way it's evolved, you know, over time, how it locates us, say, with a kind of women's space of the home. So New York and cities blotted into wilderness, I think it might be that there are certain biographic materials that are pushing and pulling the way in which I'm narrating the works. And the intention is more to think through those cuts, because the first print in Home is a Foreign Place is the only one we see really in aerial view. And that gives us a kind of orientation. And then with New York, it's the print that is another cut. It's not an aerial view. It's a kind of, you know, abstracted elevation. But thank you so much for that comment. I hope that answers it somewhat.
Thank you. And we have time for the final question, which is in the Q&A, but I also wondered if Jolene, you wanted to sort of ask directly the question. It's a question for Elena about Kim Lim. It's a really interesting question. And obviously you've done a lot of work on Kim Lim, Jolene. So are you there? Do you think, would you like to show yourself and ask the question?
Hello. Hi. Hello, Dorothy. Hi, everyone. Hi. Thank you, Elena, for your presentation. Yeah, I just wanted to find out more from your perspective how you decided to read these early works in terms of reconciliation. And also very curious because from my understanding, Kim Lim, I guess it was in many ways from a kind of powerful and well-connected family and would be rather shielded from what we know of as tragedies of war in Southeast Asia at the time. Yeah, I just would like to find out more and whether you think, whether you'd also choose to read her subsequent later works through this lens. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, I'm not sure I understood exactly everything about the question, but I'll try to answer maybe. And
in the Q&A, or shall I read it to you?
Do you mind? Sorry, there was a problem with the audio.
Audio, okay, yeah, fine. I'll read it as well. So she says, thank you for the presentation. Important study of Kim Lim's early works, which have not so far been written about. I wonder if you can kindly share more on your perspectives on reading Kim Lim's early works through the lens of reconciliation. Mm-hmm. To Jolene's knowledge, Kim Lim's not spoken about her lived childhood experiences in terms of trauma. And one might say she was protected from the tragedies somewhat of the war because she was the daughter of a magistrate and from an esteemed, well-connected family, which you pointed out. And so Jolene says she'd love to know more about how this unfolded for her while she was in London. And would you consider her subsequent works through this lens as well?
Yeah. So this is one of the reasons actually I mentioned particularly the two main sources I use in my writing, including a very expansive interview from 1995 with Artists' Lives, because that's one of the few instances in which we hear Kim's voice. It's a wonderful recording, and as Cathy Corney always does, she digs deeper and deeper in early memories. And this is probably, you know, and you can at times hear maybe Kim Lim being slightly uncomfortable or, you know, not being used to talk that in detail about her early experiences, but she does. And it was also fascinating for me to listen to the recording and compare to what has primarily been written about her childhood. So for example, she said very clearly, you know, her father was not working now. He was cultivating this veggie garden. They had very little. She experienced hunger. She was sent to live with a family on the top of the hill at the sort of more dramatic moment on the invasion. And actually she goes into quite specific details about that story that has never been used in narratives of her life. And I think really provides a very, I think, richer understanding, certainly, of her childhood. And in terms of the questions about reconciliation, was it particularly how I use reconciliation? This is, again, you know, particularly an attempt to, as I was trying to particularly draw out towards the end of my paper, the fact that she references these very strong figures of male authority in her narrative. And actually this, I didn't have a chance to highlight, but in her own narratives about her childhood, there are these military figures that she, you know, she has these very strong memories of in childhood. But she also very clearly states in that same interview that she does not hold individuals account for histories that they were not necessarily protagonists of. And she also always said very clearly that the way she could engage, for example, with Japanese culture, with her love of Japanese gardens, and that all these different ways of engaging with reality could equally coexist. And for me, the using, you know, particular reconciliation and this the sort of reconfiguration of these figures like the samurai in a very early work is just an attempt to try and make sense of an artist in her early 20s after having come to London is creating all these sculptures and also lithographs of these Japanese figures of authority. And of course, you know, there are, can be different views, and I would love Jolene to comment if she interprets them differently.
Jolene, would you like to have the final say? What your take? Hi.
Hi, hello. Thank you. Thanks for sharing that. It was very informative. I guess one could then that's one way of looking at early works. I'm also interested to know if you'd read this in her later works, her subsequent works, or is this just something you think is more applicable to reading her early series of works, or this small body of works?
The work shifts quite considerably, both formally and in terms of the themes in the mid-60s. And while there are certainly themes that go across the work, I really felt I wanted to look at his early works. The reason I wanted to do that is Kim Lim is consistently read in terms of post-minimalism and post-conceptualism.
Mm.
If we look at these early works, we see that what she's doing much later on, you know, playing with wooden permutations, you know, permutation of wooden elements, as a completely direct link to what she was doing at this moment. Formally, the world becomes more geometric, more symmetrical, but actually there is so much in the activity of using found objects, of using construction, of working on these arrangements, which are slightly off balance, which very much runs through. So on one side, for me, looking at the early work was trying to find and discuss a different origin, possibly, of the later development. We can see as distinct from necessarily just minimalism and conceptualism, but also looking at the specific themes she addresses here. I think in works like Borneo from 66, again, you can see her returning to the region, returning to the history of her family, and particularly the side of her family, which came from Borneo. But she's at that moment, I think, doing something which is more abstracted, both formally and thematically. And I don't have an image, so it's more difficult to discuss, but I think there is certainly a journey that goes is a bit removed from the specificity of this early work.
Yeah, thank you so much for sharing. You can see really how Kim Lim's lived experiences really does inform many areas of her practice, and it's really wonderful to hear such a refreshing take on her early work, so thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for the question as well, Jolene. And it just remains for me to thank all of our speakers again for their great talks this afternoon. It's been a really interesting and rich panel, and I think there's lots more to talk about, and it's not over yet, and I'll talk about that in a minute. I also want to just thank quickly this morning's keynote, Shigemi Inaga, and also to thank the audience, to you, to Shauna and Danny from the PMC who've helped navigate our Zoom bombing, and to Sarah, Ming and Hamad as well for convening the session. And also to invite everybody, if they want to join, there's a post-panel chat, and Danny will share the link. Oh, there it is. So there's a link in in the chat for everyone who, if you've got time and you want to continue the conversations in a more informal way, then please do click on the link and join the post panel chat. And I don't think there's a break, although I'm wondering whether we should have a 5-minute break, but yeah, maybe we just go straight into the post panel chat and then we can negotiate if we want a break when we're in there. So yeah, thank you very much, everyone. It's been a great afternoon. Thanks for your contributions.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.